And now, the conclusion. We have to talk about our cast of characters. I love these characters. They are unique in the franchise. This is a time when we are getting away from... there was elements of this in some of the the more immediate movies preceding this, but we really get away from the typical kinds of characters that we see. Our reporters, our scientists, our soldiers, like characters like that are bit players in this. These are perfectly ordinary people doing interesting but technically very ordinary jobs by comparison to reporter, scientist, and soldier.
They're a little bit less likely to be on the front lines of a story like this. Like, look at the cast of Mothra versus Godzilla, for example, right? We have a reporter, his photographer, and the scientist. If you look at Ghidorah the Three-Headed Monster, we have the police officer, the reporter...
Police officer scientist is a little different, but it's still soldier adjacent.
That falls into the same trope of
and to a lesser extent the politicians.
Because if you have think about it in the context of these movies, what are journalists and police officers if not seekers of the truth and justice, right? Mm-hmm. So it works. Like Shindo is trying to solve a mystery in that film, and honest to God, so is Sakai in Mothra versus Godzilla. They're both trying to find the truth and protect people. So it's the same trope. In Godzilla versus Gigan, we've got a down on his luck manga artist, his girlfriend who insults him but also believes in him and knows karate and has questionable taste in fashion.
How dare you?
No. I think she looks great and she has a great taste in fashion, but clearly Gengo picks on her, and that's funny. We'll get there.
I love their relationship.
Oh, it's so charming. You have their friend who's just kind of eats corn and bananas, and he's a hippie.
He's a vagabond. We don't even know if he actually has a job. I mean,
like, there's really nothing.
He could be a freeloader as far as he looks like a freeloader.
All we know is that the sister, Machiko, of our kidnapped dude locked up.
He's not a scientist. I think he's an engineer, if I remember correctly.
He's not a scientist. Engineer. He's building things.
It's scientist adjacent, so it kind of counts.
He's what we're trying to find. So we have four main characters, excluding Takeshi Shima, who's locked up. And we have these people. We've got the artist, the girlfriend, the karate girlfriend, the hippie, and the sister.
To go back to random bits of English, is the way they find him, because there's a mystery in the first act of this movie, which is kind of fun, where they're trying to figure out what the heck is going on. Who are these weirdos? And I really like it, actually, in retrospect, mm-hmm. because it dominates the first 20, 30 minutes of the movie. And one of the ways that they find him is that his initials are on his lighter, TS, and I don't mean Elliot. Oh, come on, Jimmy. Come on.
Jimmy, you're... That's beautiful, man.
Oh, jeez.
Sorry, Nate.
Yeah, true.
So we have
these cast of characters. They are not the ones you would typically think would be in a movie like this, and there hasn't really been characters like this since.
Not really. I mean, the next movie, the main character is an inventor and his buddy and his brother, and then we go back to, what do we get, an archaeologist? So we get scientists again, and then we go to an Interpol agent, and then we jump to reporters again, and cops, and military. Like, it becomes a thing. The craziest it gets after this is a psychic shows up. She's also kind of a truth seeker, and she gets roped into the military.
Yeah.
So
yeah, Singular Point has a graduate student, but she's a science-based graduate student. And
like the closest, like the Godzilla 2000 kind of almost gets there because it's very like these blue collar, like people who,
some of them used to be scientists,
but they're science. Again, it's that there's a scientific element there. And then you get the rest of the Millennium era is it's either reporters, military, or both. And then once you get into the Monsterverse, it's military and scientists. So this is pretty, now I'm not saying it hasn't occurred again in a few other places, but like the lead character of this movie is a down on his luck artist, an illustrator.
I was going to say, please tell me you,
you of all people, Danny, like me, especially after you got a little older, you feel Gengo's pain.
Gengo and I would be.
Like, that editor scene at the beginning of this, I'm like, oh, yeah.
I think it stinks.
Yeah. Oh, oh.
Like,
that is every writer and artist dealing with an editor right there and saying, like, you suck. Don't come back. And
your life is worthless. You smell funny.
Now, in the editor's defense, I'm sorry. Either Gengo was coming up with an excuse for his own laziness or uncreativity at that moment, or his ideas are so esoteric that they're beyond most audiences. He's operating on another level. You know, saying like,
they don't understand my vision.
They don't understand my vision. Like, the psychic energy from kids is going to get funneled into this panel, and it'll make the homework monster. And I'm like,
Gengo. Gengo was playing some like 14D chess.
Yeah.
Maybe. There, his chakras were aligned, man. He was about to start levitating with artistic prowess.
Yeah. And then the editor still just tells him. It reminds me of J. Jonah Jameson a little bit, that editor there.
Kids need something a little more complicated now, you know?
Yeah. Kids are too sophisticated. Again, the meta commentary. But that's what makes it interesting. So we have a character, we have a main character who has a very clear goal and motivation. I need a new job, which is what leads him to the World Children's Lab so he can get a gig there. And, you know, we throw in the girlfriend who... All right, Mr. Graham... Mr. Author of Godzilla, the Official Guide to the King of the Monsters, you done goofed.
Oh.
He said that, remind me the girl's name again.
Tomoko.
He said Tomoko was his wife.
Oh, no.
In his chapter on this movie, he said she was his wife. And I'm like, you are the only guy who thinks that they're married.
Accidents happen.
It just cracked me up when I saw that. But, you know, and so he's got a girlfriend, very good girlfriend, very pretty girlfriend. And I like to think that Gengo's sitting there thinking, he's like, you know what? I'm even lucky to have her. I'm lucky that she even looks in my direction. I need to get a job to keep her.
She is so supportive of him. And I love that.
And she has a job. She mentions, I work already. The fact that you're even here is because I made arrangements for it.
Uh-huh. Which is also another thing, because this was a few years into the major women's lib movement in Japan taking root. So the idea, like the fact that she's this karate kicking girlfriend who has a job when her boyfriend doesn't, that is part of the women's lib thing that had taken root in Japan in the 60s. Yeah. And it also feeds into another aspect of the movie, which I'll circle back to. But one of the main themes that that goes over people's heads in America, but was a driving theme of the script in Japan, was women's lib. And she's a part of that. But at the same time, she is his manager, basically.
Yeah.
She's organizing for him to get the opportunities. She's the one who hooks him up with the Godzilla Tower job at World Children's Land. So the fact that she teases him and kind of roughs him up a little bit and bullies him, and then he joshes her back.
It's charming.
And you can tell that they like she believes in him.
Yeah, she does. Every straight guy, I should say, in the world wants a woman as supportive as Tomoko.
Everyone in general, like, I have to imagine, like, any woman out there, any guy, whatever, would want a partner who, you know, helps them try to achieve their dreams in some way, believes that they can do it. It's not a guy thing or a girl thing. It's universal.
True. I tend to think of it in more, you know, in terms of like a context like this. Yeah.
No. I get you. Yeah. But it's definitely charming. And
which is one of the detriments with the dub, because the dub makes him meaner. The joke we opened, I introduced you with, I've always felt like that is so completely unnecessary.
It was.
Now, I will admit, the funny thing is, as much as I hate that line in retrospect, I do love the line that the dub gives them later that is not in the Japanese. That one I find charming, which is, you know, when she's like, oh, I see a resemblance when she's looking at his monster designs and he's actually making Mama Gon and the homework, Ashukra, the homework monster. And he's like, and, you know, and then she says in the dub, "You cheeky pig."
You cheeky pig.
I love it.
I love the "you cheeky pig" line. In Japanese, she says, "You made me a monster."
Oh, also, I'm a monster, am I?
I'm a monster. Yeah, something like that. Like, I become a monster. And that's also charming and funny, but like the cheeky pig line is like,
yeah.
You can tell this was dubbed by British people.
I'm trying to remember in your novelization, I don't think you did. I think there was an earlier draft where you had the original dub line, the infamous dub line, which I think you've since changed. If I remember correctly,
I never included "you cheeky pig."
I would have wanted that so much.
I fully plan on incorporating that gag somewhere else as an homage. But since I try to follow the original Japanese dialogue as close as I can, it didn't feel right to change it.
Right, it's one of those things where you might have to grant it a little bit of leeway. It's kind of like when you start getting into, as Jimmy is still waiting for.
Yes, he is.
Still waiting for as a patron.
Very patient.
As a patron, when you start doing Invasion of Astro Monster, Monster Zero, or whatever, you're going to have to make a decision. Commandant or controller?
Commandant or controller, yeah.
And I don't think anyone would hold it against you if you went with controller. I think controller makes more sense. And I think it's just the better name. And then another one is, do you go with the subtitled lines for Mr. Nick Adams, the spirit animal for my producer? Or do you use what he actually said on set, which we can hear in the dub?
I'm going to use what actually came out of his mouth.
Yeah.
Like that's that plan. That's off topic.
Yeah. It's off topic. I'm just saying, like, it's one of those things you have to make a decision.
Yeah,
you
know, it's true. And it's Gigan is one of those movies that I've thought about a lot in terms of the novelization, because it is the one I've made the most progress on, or one of them. So I've spent a lot of time thinking about the characters of this film and their interactions with each other and how charming I find them and how you can recreate that in prose. That's another reason this movie's special for me.
Yeah. And then Gengo becomes a truth seeker because he's like, my bosses are weird. What is
my bosses
going on?
Like? Heiwa, peace.
Yeah,
heiwa.
Yeah. And that's another one. They say perfect peace, which I like the alliteration of it in the dub. I think that sounds really cool. But the subtitles always say something different. It's either, I think, the Criterion set, because as I have been covering the Godzilla movies, my journey has been with the Criterion discs, because it's I'm watching them for the first time in their entirety. And I think in the Criterion set, it says absolute peace, which I'm like, okay, I get what you mean. That probably makes a little bit more sense in terms of translation, but I like the sound of perfect peace. But that's because I grew up, that dub is so ingrained in my head that it's
a nice
hard
ideal
to get around it. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
So there he becomes a truth seeker. He's trying to unravel this mystery. And the deeper he gets into it, the scarier things get. And then he starts awkwardly trying to cover things up. He's like, oh, hi. I'm not supposed to be here, but hi.
It's so wonderful,
he stumbles into the evil lair with the rotating chair of evil, which apparently is from Battle in Outer Space.
A lot of reused stuff. And the music that plays in that scene is from Frankenstein Conquers the World.
He's just like walking around, it's like, the heck is this? I didn't see this room before. Oh, it's a club. Whoa! And he like slips
he does a Peter Sellers. He does the Pink Panther. He literally, we must find that woman. Down he goes.
Yeah.
Like he literally does. He does a Peter Sellers, and then he has to like clear his throat when he answers the phone because his voice is all high pitched.
He's trying to disguise his voice. You know, like he is the epitome of in over his head, and he's. And it's not that hard for him to get in over his head because he's not the kind of character you would normally see here. I mean, even his girlfriend gets in over his head and she knows karate.
It's true.
Because she, even though she knows karate, she's still a regular person.
Yeah. And I mean, Hiroshi Ishikawa, I secretly, not so secretly, because I'm about to say it, wish that he'd done another Godzilla movie or two, because I think he's just so, I've used the word charming a lot and I'm going to say it again here. I think he is just a charming lead in this. He's just fun. He's just a fun protagonist. He's an atypical protagonist, still to this day, an atypical protagonist. And all the other characters bounce off of him nice and he off of them. His interactions with our villains, who we need to talk about, is great. But I love him. He's one of my top favorite Godzilla protagonists.
Oh, yeah. Awesome. Well, and I think it's because we understand him. We feel his pain.
We get him a little bit. There are a lot of Godzilla, like, people out there in the Godzilla community who are artists, illustrators, writers, that just, I know so many creative people because of Godzilla. It inspires so much creativity. I feel like Gengo kind of has, it was inevitable that he was going to be so beloved. And I think people really do like him because there are a lot of people in the Godzilla community who probably can't help but see themselves in him just a little bit.
Yeah. And you know, and what's interesting is to see him kind of develop over the course of the movie, because he starts taking a bit more charge of situations and trying to find ways to contribute to it. I mean, it was his idea to say, like, how about we send a small force and kind of sneak our way there? They won't see it coming. I know where things are because I've been in the tower. So the soldiers are, this was a thought I had in my most recent viewing. We rag so much on the whole Kenny trope, but there's a variation of it in this movie. The military are deferring to civilians.
Yeah, basically.
Because the civilians know things about the tower because they've been in it. They haven't. So they have to rely on what the civilians are saying, and then they do what the civilians say.
Yeah, and I love how, I just love it. There's a version of it in the original cut, but the dub has one of my favorite lines ever, where it's like, they're keeping my brother locked up. I can prove it. This is his lighter. Imagine being the police officer hearing that. It's like, what does that mean, ma'am? What are you talking about?
Basic.
This is his life. Cool. Here's my badge. Here's my left ear. What are you talking about?
Like, basically, like,
I can prove that I have a pet dog at home. Here's my wallet. What do you mean? What are you talking about? I love the dub so much.
It's a good dub. It's a quirky but fun little dub. And you know, and so we've talked about him and the girlfriend. I still find it hilarious that Gengo must be able to work fast. Either that or he's had a life-size poster of him and all of his new friends sitting in his closet or something, because for no apparent reason, when they're like, I know how we can stop the Godzilla Tower and keep it from killing Godzilla, let's put explosives in the elevator. All right, that sounds like a good idea. And you know what? Let's put in this giant poster I did of everybody and, you know, in the manga style. I don't know why we need that, but sure, put it in.
I feel like I've seen so many different interpretations of that from people online, mostly from people who aren't like, probably don't know, you know, like, oh, do the bugs have bad eyesight? Do they think that's really them? Or like, my interpretation was always those bugs were going to shoot at whoever was coming up, because they knew that people were onto them. Oh, the cops are here. The military's here. It's those guys again. They were going to open fire. So the last thing that they see are the heroes pointing at them. That's a calling card saying, screw you, we got you.
Yeah, either that or maybe the bugs had to shoot it to trigger the bomb.
No, well, they clearly did have to shoot it to trigger the bomb.
Yeah, so maybe if there was nothing there, there's something like, huh, boxes?
Yeah, they probably wouldn't have fired. So maybe there was an element of, ooh, a vague human shape, let's start shooting. But it really feels like they probably would have just shot into that open elevator the minute it opens. Maybe, I don't know, maybe. I can't imagine that they thought that those were real people.
Right.
But
I'm just saying, that was Gengo's biggest contribution, was he actually got to use his art to stick it to his evil bosses. Don't we all wish we could do that? I wish I could do that. Do you see who I work for?
And we've already talked a little bit about Kubota, but it is worth mentioning how wonderfully evil like that guy is.
He's just got such a punchable villain face.
Oh, he's he's a piece of work. Toshiaki Nishizawa, and we mentioned it before that he did some TV work and a few other, he was in a lot of stuff, but I find his performance in this to be so unsettling. You could almost think that he's like a corpse wandering around. Like there's something very detached about him and very focused. Like I mentioned before, like he doesn't blink a lot if he blinks at all. There's something inhuman going on.
Maybe he's a final war zillion.
Maybe that's where they got that idea. They swiped it from the cockroaches. I don't know, man. Like he's good. He's a good villain. He's got a smug smile and he's a good villain. I like him. And then Fumio is very focused and disarming because he's a child.
Well, he appears to be a child. Now I will admit when I was younger, maybe it was because the dub voice definitely does not sound like a teenager, but I never quite bought that he was supposed to be 17. Watching it now with subtitles, I can believe it better now.
I believe that too. It's a little bit more, but like as a child, I never really registered that he was a teenager either. And until Gengo literally says he's just a child, I'm like, is he?
Yeah.
Is that what it'll look like?
Although,
what is that?
I gotta say, and this was with some side characters in this, but in what I think might be one of the most Sekizawa moments in the entire movie, because he used humor, he used satire, but it was usually pretty subtle. He was not the kind of writer who would, he's not Mel Brooks, is what I'm saying, you know, where it's kind of in your face and crazy and all that. Where the corncob hippie and Gengo travel out of town to go meet Fumio's family because they're like, yeah, that's what he looked like. Must be him. Let's go see him. And that's when they find out, oh, he's been dead for a year. And was it the grandfather? I think it was the grandfather.
It was the priest. It was the village priest.
Oh, the village priest. That's right.
Presiding over the memorial
service.
He's
like looking around in there because they're talking. Was it his mother or the grandmother? I can't remember.
That is his mom.
It's his mom. Okay. So she's like, oh, he's been dead for a year and I love him so. And then she wanders off and they start trying to talk to the priest to get a little more information. And he actually kind of looks over. He's like, well, you want to know? It's like, really? He was doing advanced math. And he looks over. He's like, is she here? she's out of earshot. He was dumb as a box of rocks.
Yeah, like he actively looks to make sure he's not offending the mom. But I love that they like, well, tell me, what is this guy that you think is this dead person? Like, what's he like? And they talk him up. They're like, well, we think he's an evil, alien. They say, well, he's a genius. He does like mathematics and, you know, global positioning and astronomy stuff. And he has a wheelchair.
Yeah.
And so they talk him up and he's like, oh, there's no way that's the same guy. The guy I knew was dumber than a bag of hammers.
Yeah.
Like this
is
guy was
calculating the trajectory of Nebula M Space Hunter for fun. It would make more sense if he was doing Nebula M 78, but I'm just saying.
this guy was a couple bubbles short of an oxygen destroyer. He's not memeing that. There you go. Like he's not a bright dude. So that little take is funny because it's an unsettling moment, but the opportunity for a very natural kind of just haha moment is really great.
Yeah. Oh, and the other, and since we're still talking about the characters, because there's so many great character moments in this movie. The other one that this actually might be the most Sekizawa moment in the entire movie. And we've already been hinting at it because we keep calling Shosaku is his actual name.
Yeah.
His actual name. We keep calling him Corncob Hippie. We call him Corncob Hippie because he literally mugs Gengo with a cob of corn.
It's brilliant.
He's like, he meets the girl because he bumps into the sister because she's running away from the bad guys. That's our first indication. Well, not our first, but it's our next big indication that things are weird because she's like, okay. And she dropped the tape and he's like, what is the tape? So he's a little suspicious. And then he meets the girl walking home from work late at night, and then Shosaku comes up behind him and he's wearing sunglasses, got all the get up and everything, and and he's like, yeah, get the tape, you know, and all that. And he thinks he's got a gun on him. And they're like, oh wait, that's not everything we need. Where's all this stuff? And he's like, Tell us where it is. And Gecko passes out.
He just swoons. Down he goes.
And then they're like, what did he do that for? And he's like, oh. He flips it in his hand. He thought it was good.
And he's got this corn, like, ear of corn wrapped up in tinfoil.
And then to add insult to injury, in the next scene, he's eating it. when Gengo wakes up.
Yeah, he's just eating it. And he says, and like, where's the guy, like, with the, where's the guy with
where's
the pistol?
Where's your pistol? And he's like, oh, you mean this?
Oh, you mean this? And he has it. That's a recurring thing, because later on he eats the banana. So his thing is like he just kind of wanders around and eats.
Actually, that brings up, just reminds me of something. I wrote this down in my notes. One of the funniest but yet strangely intellectual lines from Callett's essay on this movie is, confusion is endemic. Because everybody in this movie is confused.
There's a lot of mistaken, he points out rightfully so, that there's a lot of mistaken identity in this film. There's a lot of people, like he thinks that the corn is a gun. It's possible at the end, maybe it's possible that the aliens think that the manga drawing are people, and that's why they opened fire. And there's so many different instances of the characters just being like, okay, well, we think that this guy is this guy, but this guy is dead. Turns out they're bugs. You know, like, even the Godzilla Tower plays into that case of mistaken identity element that runs throughout the movie. So Callett is very right, as he typically is in his writing when it comes to this stuff.
Yeah. And, well, funny enough, we were talking about Tomoko and how she's this tough karate girl, but she's scared of bugs.
Yes, she's scared of bugs.
That's one of the great ironies, because she sees an actual earth cockroach later. She's like, oh my gosh, Gengo, hold me. And then
it's like that the one moment where the tough veneer goes away. The rest of the time, they literally, like, they send her in first. She's a war machine. You don't want to mess with Tomoko.
When her and Gengo are running up the stairs in the Godzilla Tower, he gets tired first.
He wipes out.
And she's like, oh, you wimp. Hey, come on.
Another great line of the dub. Get up. Are you a man?
Makes me think of when Sarah Connor starts yelling at Kyle Reese in the first Terminator. Like, she
on your feet, soldier.
Yeah, she pretends to be a drill sergeant for a second to get him to get his act together. And then she goes back to being softer because she's like, help me. And, but she
had to
be tough.
That's what we call foreshadowing.
Yeah,
kids.
She had to be tough for a second there. And so it's kind of the same thing here. But,
Bit. And then she goes in and kicks everybody's butt. And it's great. Another very strong Sekizawa had been writing awesome heroines since the 60s. So even though this was definitely in the middle of the women's lib movement in Japan, it could be argued that him, like Sekizawa alongside Honda, was doing stuff like this. Not as overtly with the karate. That's a little on the nose, right? It's a little bit different, but the Godzilla series was no stranger to strong female characters at this point.
I got to say, I appreciate, as as a writer, that we had payoff for that, because in the first scene she's in, she's like, "What?" And then he's like, "Oh, I'm not telling you what I said because you scare me. You have a black belt in karate." And we get payoff later because she karate's some people.
She karate's some people. We get payoff. There's a lot of reincorporation in darn good payoff. If you introduce karate in the first act, you better use it in the third, right? So she gets to use it in the second and the third. Chekhov's karate. Chekhov's black belt. We get Chekhov's manga. We get Chekhov's a couple of other things in here. We get plenty of that. So this is a smartly written script. Like, this is a competent script. It's a competent story. A lot better than, its reputation for some people might lead them to believe.
Yeah, I think, like, Galbraith wasn't nice to it, but,
It's fine.
Galbraith is grumpy. Because he said that he doesn't understand why the Nebulans would hire Gengo. It's like, because they want an artist and they're trying to maintain the facade. Why wouldn't they?
Also, it's a fantasy movie. That's
and he says that the script has, he described it at the structure of the script as a yo-yo because they keep going back and forth between the Godzilla Tower. Like, why is that a problem?
That's more of an, I feel like that's an observation and not an issue, but they do kind of yo-yo.
In the context of him being grumpy, it came across as such.
He's entitled. He's entitled to his opinion. He's cool.
Yeah.
It's all good.
He's softened since then. He's apparently less grumpy now as an old guy than he was as a young guy.
Hmm.
Kind of weird.
What have we not talked about yet?
The monsters. We should talk more about the monsters.
We should.
Yeah, yeah, because there's some interesting things that happen with the monsters. So I mentioned that Gigan is our one new monster in this. Funny enough, he's a cyborg. They don't come out and say that, but you know, if you look at his design, he's a cyborg. Funny enough, I wish I had opened this box when we were at G-Fest and didn't just take it back with me. But I was gifted a box of stuff by our mutual friend John LeMay, and I opened it for the MIFV Max members on Patreon and showed it off, you know, along with all the other stuff I got at the con. But there was a figure in it that I was a bit baffled by at first, and you told me later that you really, really wanted, because it's a bootleg Gigan figure, and you're one of those guys who has a strange appreciation for bootleg kaiju figures.
I do.
And I, on the fly, came up with some lore for the figure, which is that, because when you look at it, there's no, it has an actual eye and not a visor, there's no hammer claws, it has the general shape of Gigan, but it doesn't have the trademark accoutrement. And my theory is that this is pre-cyborg Gigan.
Yeah, it's an Imperial style. It was not made by Imperial, but there are different, there are actually a couple different companies that used this mold, this Gigan-esque mold, the Please Don't Sue Us Gigan. And it has two eyes, it has hands with two fingers and feet with two toes, and perfectly, like, no buzzsaw, and I think, you know, some very small fins on the back to imply that the flying wings that Gigan has, and smaller horns, things like that. For all the world, it looks like what Gigan might very well have looked like before whatever happened to him happened to him. And that's one of the reasons I've always been fascinated with that figure. And even though I have a pretty substantial collection of Godzilla bootlegs, that Gigan has always eluded me for whatever reason. So I'm going to be very happy to throw him on my shelf with my, I think I'm going to put him next to my Mexican bootleg Godzilla.
Oh, there you go. But
they match.
I've heard Gigan be described some funny ways. I've heard him be described as a cyborg chicken. That's probably the funniest one. I've also heard him just be described as a penguin. I'm still not 100% sure what he is, other than to say he's definitely
70s.
I wouldn't say necessarily 70s. He's very ultra kaiju.
He's very TV 70s.
Yeah, I was going to say, what was the name of the guy who was the kaiju designer on Ultraman? Because Toho's monster designer at the contemporary at the time, he went for more grounded designs, very dinosaurian, very believable. And the guy who worked on for Tsuburaya with Ultraman is like, I'm going to go nuts.
that gentleman was Tol Narita.
That's Tol Narita. Like, Tol Narita was just wild. That's why Ultra Kaiju to this day are crazy.
Yeah.
And Gigan looks like he could have come from Tol Narita.
A little bit, yeah. Definitely an interesting creature, almost like destined to be instantly iconic in a way. It has a unique silhouette. Gigan is one of my top favorite monsters.
Oh, I love, which is why I was shocked that it took as long as it did for him to come back. Because, like, I had always gotten the impression Gigan was well liked because he's so wild. The hammer claws, the buzzsaw belly, the visor eye, the sharp bladed horns, the big fins on his back. Yeah, yeah, and then he has like these like bladed, big bladed toes on his feet, like that look kind of like the hammer claws.
He's cool. Like, he was a little too wild for the Heisei era, a little.
Which is saying a lot.
It's saying a lot, but like there weren't any like the craziest that, honest to God, the craziest that they got was Mecha King Ghidorah. I mean, we have the big bugs. That's not that wild. We have some robots. We have a space Godzilla.
Godzilla with all those crystals, man.
Yeah, but he's not a cyborg space chicken, right? Like, there's a difference. Gigan is a completely wild 1970s TV monster, and even though the Heisei era was conceptually crazy with this kaiju, half Rose, half Godzilla, anyone, Gigan is not conceptually crazy, he's visually crazy. And not nearly at the same level as something like a Biollante or a Space Godzilla. They were like kind of crazy, but they had a logic to them. Gigan's just nuts. The best way.
I found this quotation from Nakano, and it admittedly it's from IMDb, so you may have to take it with a grain of salt. maybe, but mm-hmm. he was quoted as saying that the idea for Gigan, they wanted to do something that had a very different shape, and what he says was their inspirations from it is kind of wild. Like he said, they originally wanted to make something that was, that he described as quote unquote, a richly colored dinosaur that was inspired by the, I hope I say this right, Junhito kimonos that were worn by Japanese court ladies.
Well, they did just put out a Gigan apron a year or so ago.
Why not? And then, the actual designer, well, maybe not designer, but it's a guy named Mizuki. I don't see his first name in this quotation. But he said he came up with two different potential looks for Gigan. One was triangular and was resemblant of the final design. Another one was more circular and had a number of quote-unquote hemispheres across the body. And he wanted to make something that was sharp and florid and took inspiration from birds. So there you go.
There you go. And Mizuki-san, his first name is escaping me, but he was one of the lead designers.
He says he based Gigan's form on migratory birds like geese and adopted the sharpness of an eagle from the neck up. That I can see, but geese?
Yeah. He's very bird-like. Like, this is a very bird-like creature.
Remind me next time I bump into Gigan at the island to call him a silly goose.
Oh, for goodness sake. Oh, for goodness sake. Oh, dear God. Oh, dear God.
Are you looking for Mizuki?
I thought I'd try to... I don't remember what his first name is, but he was on there. The big name for Gigan that probably has the most impact on the film is Yasumaru-san.
Oh, Takayoshi Mizuki.
Thank you. Oh, my gosh. Brain fart on
my part. Yeah, he was a Shonen Magazine illustrator.
Yes. Yes, he
was. Which actually makes sense. So it's a comic book artist designing Gigan. Synergy.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And this was around the time that the Shonen stuff was like really kicking into high gear and entering a new phase of popularity, early 70s and all throughout the rest of the decade. So that lines up. That absolutely lines up.
There's a lot of pop art influence in this. I would say all the 70s Godzilla movies have something of a pop art influence. Even Hedorah to a certain extent has it. Actually, maybe Hedorah has it the most, along with all the other weirdness. But it's almost more direct in this with some of the choices that they make. And I would say one of the most underappreciated things in this movie in terms of that is the cinematography. Like, there's brilliant cinematography in this. They're working with a lower budget, but Fukuda and Nakano, they figure out how to shoot everything in it to make it look good.
They were a good team.
They were. I would argue that there are shots in this film, particularly with the monster stuff, that if you paused it and you screenshot it, that's a comic book cover. In particular, I think when you have this, the composition on this shot is so good, where you have Godzilla getting brutalized by the Godzilla Tower in the foreground. You've got Gigan in the center of the frame, and you got Anguirus in the foreground, and he's like, what am I going to do? I need to get to my buddy, but Buzzsaw Boy's in my way. What do I do? And then you just see him. He's just thinking, like, what do I do? What do I do? And then he makes a decision. He's like, I'm going forward.
I have to take the hit. And he does.
Because I'm Anguirus, and that's what I do.
And even that show, like, the idea that manga as an art form is baked into this film's DNA is very, very accurate.
The voice some bubbles.
The voice bubbles are literally, the voice bubbles for when the monsters talk to each other. Nakano was a little hesitant on doing that. He thought that was a big swing. That was stylistically a big, that was like on the level of having Godzilla dance in the 60s. Yeah, like, this is that.
Except the way I look at it, and this is why I do think the dub does the movie a disservice by removing the voice bubbles and doing that. That was actually Ted Thomas. Scratches. That was actually Ted Thomas, by the way.
That was Ted, voices. Yes. That was Ted Thomas. So Ted Thomas, this is a little fun fact for your next trivia night, gentlemen, ladies, is Ted Thomas is one of the only human actors to, in terms of live action, he's the only human actor to ever voice Godzilla. Now, if you want to talk Hanna-Barbera, we'll throw Ted Cassidy in there. But I'm talking live action. Like, he is an actor who gave Godzilla a voice and talked. It's the only time that's ever happened.
Yeah.
In a live action film. This
yeah,
was it.
Yeah. Ted Thomas. Yeah. I'll bring up why I think the voice bubbles still work, as weird as they are, and then we got to do the promised reenactment.
We should.
But the way I look at it is that it isn't actually all that weird. It's just there for the audience. It doesn't exist in universe. The fact that the monsters are communicating with each other, that's not unbelievable at all. Animals talk to each other in their own forms of communication. They do it all the time. That's not strange. The fact that these voice bubbles are popping up because, again, the pop art influence, the manga, the manga artists and all that, it is definitely within the framework of this movie. Those are just there as a little bit of style to let the audience know this is what they're saying. Because obviously nobody in the audience, even now, unless you have the orca, speaks kaiju.
That's true. It's almost like they're not part of the universe of the film. They're thought bubbles. It's a stylistic choice to help tell the movie. It's part of creating a reality that you step into. It is like the beginning of this movie is pages on a manga being flipped, right?
Yeah.
So it's setting us up for that. And I love the word bubbles.
Yeah,
I think that's funny.
It's definitely more creative than just putting subtitles up.
Oh yeah, it's huge. And again, Nakano was a little worried about it, but he took a swing. And according to him, the reaction from the children in the audience was relieving for him. And he actually used that as inspiration for the posters and the advertising for Godzilla versus Megalon, which used word bubbles.
Yep.
Now, there are no word bubbles in Megalon, but he used it again for the marketing for the next movie. And he was sold on it at that point.
Yeah.
He was relieved.
Yeah. Now, I don't know why they made this decision, but they removed the bubbles and they thought, yeah, I know what makes more sense, guys. Let's actually make them literally talk.
Because that's not sillier at all.
That's not sillier at all. But I will admit, the dub dialogue is funnier than what's in the voice bubbles. And, you know, let us demonstrate, because it's embedded in our skull. So it's like, hey, Aguilas!
What do you want?
There you go.
Something funny's going on. You better check.
Okay.
Sounds like an 80s cartoon.
Yeah, say, hurry up.
Like, it's, yeah.
Then it happens again in a later scene when they're swimming. And it's
some
like,
trouble
it's like hey, Aguilas, we got a lot of trouble up ahead.
And Garrus is kind of a yes man, isn't he?
Yeah. Yes, boss. Right away, boss. You're the boss, boss.
Yeah.
Yes, dear.
What's so funny in that scene, because like it's actually the same with the voice bubble, and it's even in English in the voice bubble. It just says okay, and
okay.
With exclamation point. And you hear this. It's, I guess it's Ted Thomas, and he just says okay. It's like he doesn't even care.
Oh yeah, boss. Whatever you say, boss.
It's like Rocky and Muggsy from Looney Tunes. Yeah. Take this Gigan into the other room and let him have it, Bugsy.
Okay, boss.
Okay.
I let him have it, boss, just like you said.
Like,
yeah, but for me, the weird, kind of weirdly American, almost Midwestern kind of accent that Godzilla has, you know, you better check.
Yo, get your keister over here, Anguirus. What are you doing? Get over here, you mook. Yeah, get over here.
You sound like my friend Ricky, I'm just saying.
Actually, that did kind of sound a little like Ricky, didn't it?
Yeah, it does sound like Ricky. Huh.
Yeah, cool
weird
guy.
Yeah, weird. Cool guy. You should meet him. Well, anyway.
I should.
Yeah. But the line that always sticks out to me, and it did for Cali, because this is literally one of his chapter titles, like his intermittent chapter titles, is something funny's going on. That is not what's in the Japanese version, but it's
no,
so
but
funny.
It has become its own unique brand of iconic. I would argue that if you were to like make some kind of a conglomeration of like classic Godzilla Americana. That line would be in the on the list somewhere because it's like a contribution to the Godzilla franchise that America made that is so baked into how we think about the 70s movies and like that era. Something funny is going on. Like we remember that.
Yeah.
And it's a unique thing that's very silly but very memorable that like America gave to that film in a weird way.
Yeah.
I guess to kind of wrap up on the manga, one thing I'll mention is there was a manga adaptation of the movie. Now, a lot of them did get manga adaptations, but it is worth noting that Takeshi Furujo did do a manga adaptation of this, and it was republished relatively recently, about 8 years ago, in one of the, it was in the DVD set, one of the DVD sets that like reprinted all that great material from 2016. So if you want to try to find it, it's a little bit easier to find now. But yes, this very manga-inspired movie has its own manga adaptation out there. But there you go.
I can't wait for your novelization to get to that point. I'm like, how is he going to do this? The only thing I could think of that might be the way to do it is to get your friend Robert to do a comic strip. Where you put the lines in there. So you just like just put the voice bubble in there. Like, or maybe like that's the whole chapter. Instead of actually writing it out as prose, it's just a series of comic panels.
Oh, that'd be fun. Gosh, so we've hit on Godzilla.
Yeah.
There's
a couple things we've hinted at it, but I want to kind of wrap up some things about the condition of the suits in this.
Oh, yeah, we got to do that.
A defense that I think is a valiant defense of the condition of the Godzilla suit in this is because Godzilla gets the crap beat out of him in this movie. For years, people thought that Gigan was the guy who made Godzilla bleed, and now they're retracting that. It's like, oh, it was Hedera because he ate Godzilla's hand.
He's got blood on his face at the end of the movie, so something happens.
It's Hedera, but for years, that title belonged to Gigan, because Gigan's a sadist.
You know, Gigan's
he's a bit of a coward, too, you know, because he just kind of runs away. You know, he has a bad habit of abandoning allies, but, you know, he beats the crap out of it. Like, as soon as he was like, I got the advantage, even when the control gets undone. Because poor Ghidorah just keeps getting mind controlled by everybody and their dog. But
you'd think with three times as many brains as most aliens, he'd be better at fighting that off. Yeah, but
one of them's Kevin.
Yeah. Is that true? Is that a thing? Is that a thing in the 70s?
We actually see the heads act independently in this movie, which is kind of interesting.
They actually do. And that was very likely a result of some wonky understaffed puppetry, but it does give King Ghidorah kind of a weird character in this that he didn't have in the previous films.
It's kind of fascinating. It's like a little thing that you kind of take for granted, but it's like all three heads kind of sit there because again they can't really make the heads move all that much, and they just stare. They like to watch. They're like, "Ooh, Gigan, do your thing." That sounded weirder than I meant it to, but anyway, like you get what I mean. And so they're sitting there and they're watching, like they're just fascinated. And then Angerus is trying to be a bad ninja and sneak over there, and then he bumps a rock, and then the right head just moves over. Is like, hey, what are you doing? Bzzzt, zaps him. The other two don't miss a beat. They just keep watching. It's just that the right head just goes over and shoots Angerus.
It's a cool little beat. It's an interesting little beat that they gave him.
Yeah. So the Toho movies at least hinted at the heads acting independently and having individual personalities.
True. I guess that works.
It's not just a MonsterVerse thing.
No.
Just saying. But like I said, Godzilla gets the snot beat out of him in this. It's kind of excruciating to watch. And, you know, and Hedera would have been the same way. They never would have done that under Tsuburaya's supervision, which is incredibly ironic to me that when he's making movies, when he's making Godzilla movies, he's like, no, we're not making the monsters bleed all the time. Oh, we're working on Ultraman? Cut their heads off. Make it
cut
gush.
Them in half. You don't, Chandler, you don't need that arm. Yoink, off it goes.
Yeah, I don't get that. It was just like, you brutalize the monsters on TV, but the movies, no.
Well, it was that brutalization of monsters on TV that ultimately ended up feeding back into the movies embracing the violent. Now, Gamera did it first. Gamera was gooey and gory and yucky and squirty and nasty.
Which is so weird.
It was so gross. And then, like, you know, Godzilla really didn't follow suit with that for quite a while. I mean, there's not even, like, a lot of human blood and violence in those movies. There's some, but there's not a lot. I mean, Destroy All Monsters a little bit.
No, Mothra versus Godzilla, man.
Mothra versus Godzilla, a guy gets shot in the face. So it's,
no,
it's not
he pretty. gets his nose broken with a few good punches.
Yeah, there's blood everywhere there. And then he, in the Japanese version, you do see blood erupt out of the back of the skull of Kumiyama-san. So a guy gets his nose broken and a guy gets shot in the back of the head. So it's not unviolent, but it's not all over the place. In Godzilla versus Gigan, there's not a lot of human, like, on alien or alien on human violence or anything like that. But Godzilla blood geysers out of his shoulder. He gets his face beat in, and Garrus literally squirts face blood on the camera.
Onto the camera, yeah.
In a very manga-like shot.
Yeah, and every time, it's funny, ever since I saw Iron Man 2, I keep thinking of this line from, I can't remember the bad guy's name in that.
Whiplash.
I think it's Whiplash.
Mickey Rourke.
Yeah, Mickey Rourke, where he goes into this little speech, and I just keep translating it into, you know, into this movie where the line is, he's like, "If you could make gold bleed,"
gold,
and then
bleed.
I just think of, you know, "If you could make Godzilla bleed," and then it's just you cut to Gigan
squirt,
just like, yeah, hitting him in the face,
blood everywhere,
you know,
punch.
Because I mean, like, it's almost the same thing in a weird way. It's just like, you know, up to this point where it's just not a scene that the audience is used to. The young audience watching these movies, they're not used to seeing Godzilla this vulnerable necessarily. I mean,
so you are mortal.
Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy. And, you know, and that's why I don't mind the condition of the suit so much in this. I know people rag on it, but it seems weirdly fitting for this movie with how much he just gets the tar beat out of him.
I think that lines up fine. I mean, for a movie where you literally on camera see parts of the suit crumble and fall off, it's a thing. And Godzilla, it is worth noting that there are two different suits used in the film. The water scenes use the Son of Godzilla, Musuko Goji suit, and that one was even older.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, that one's from 1967. That's a 5-year-old going on 6-year-old suit, and there could not have been much left of that dang thing. It was,
yeah, kind of ratty looking. Rubber does not react well to water for long.
Water and age, and also people sweating, and also another interesting fun fact: Nakajima was a drinker. He liked to drink, and when he sweat, it made the inside of the suit smell like alcohol. So that can't be
good.
Why
does Godzilla's inside smell like sake?
Yeah, like, I mean, he wasn't like, it wasn't like a problem or anything, but like he drank. He had a couple of drinks, and
I'm not drunk enough for this kaiju fight.
Yeah, like that contributed to the suits not necessarily standing up to a lot of wear and tear, or a lot of age. And Anguirus, bless him, was looking a little rough. I mean, there are moments in there where they kept using him. They used him more than the 68 Godzilla suit. He made it all the way to 1974.
Mm-hmm.
By the time Anguirus got to 1974, Godzilla versus Mechagodzilla, he didn't even have tusks anymore. Like his teeth were literally falling out. He's losing teeth. His spines were not doing so good. Like, he was a mess. But they kept dusting him off, and that ended up, those movies made him iconic.
Mm-hmm.
That set of movies right there. But Gigan, Anguirus is most iconic anything ever, I would argue, is Godzilla versus Gigan.
Oh, his trademark move that should be way more devastating than it is on screen, where he, you know, kangaroo. Not really. It's not really a kangaroo kick, but he launches himself backwards and impales Ghidorah with his carapace. And I'm like, Ghidorah should be Swiss cheese. He is a durable mofo if he could take that.
I mean, in Destroy All Monsters, he lands right on top of Anguirus on the spikes and squishes him. So we know Ghidorah's tough cookie. And of course, they reuse some of that footage here too, with some weird day for night color grading on it. So if which makes it funny to think about, because if you think about it, because this is before Destroy All Monsters chronologically, that means Anguirus bit the same spot on the same neck twice. And it worked. It did not work the first time, and he still did it again 30 years later.
Which means
20 years later.
Which means we can retcon this by Ghidorah, and they're like, "Oh, not again."
Basically, like if you watch the movies in order and take them like that, then when you get to that scene, you're like, "Oh, he's going to do the neck thing again. Let's see if it goes differently." No, he's falling again.
Yeah.
Oh, but this time there's an alien base when he falls. Cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Anguirus gets some great moments in this. But this is where the Anguirus we know and love really is solidified.
Yes.
The never say die, feisty, weirdly aggressive for such a little guy, you know, like that personality mm-hmm. really comes through here, where he's like, I don't care if I can't breathe fire or shoot missiles. I can't even stand on 2 feet for more than like 3 seconds. I don't care. Oh, you got a buzzsaw on your stomach and hammer claws and lightning beams and all that. I don't care. I will eat you.
Yeah.
I don't care what I have to do to eat you, but I will eat you.
I will ruin you.
I will mess you up.
This is where
he's so Anguirus, scrappy. He's endearingly scrappy.
That's the word I was about to use. Like, this is the moment where Anguirus became Godzilla's scrappy ally, who Godzilla is very, very willing to risk his life to protect in a couple of moments. And that's the first time that had ever been done, because at this point, like, this is Anguirus's, I mean, unless you want to count some stock footage, this is his third full movie. You don't really get the sense that they're like pals in Destroy All Monsters. They're more a part of an ensemble. And obviously in the movie before that, Anguirus's throat got torn out by Godzilla, right? So they're literally at each other's throats. And in this one, thank you. And they're pals, you know? And you could almost see that as something that evolves throughout the film. You could see it as Anguirus, Godzilla's the king of the island, the king and the god of the world he knows. And he says, hey, Anguirus, you're the closest monster to me. You're going to go check this out as my scout. And then they both go. And you could almost say that, like, by the end, they become friends. Like, this is the movie where it happens.
Yeah. I know some people say they criticize the whole thing with Anguirus leaving, but it's not all that weird to me. Now, It's a little strange that people don't trust the monsters, but I'm like, they're big and they cause trouble. So maybe they're like, I don't know why you're here, but even if you're trying to be nice, you're so big, you cause trouble. We know what Honda said about being too big and too strong and too tall and all that. It's like, can you leave us alone? Oh, okay, well, we have to shoot you. I'm sorry.
at this point in the franchise, the monsters are operating on their own agenda. Their own agendas that are completely separate from the humans. In the previous films, the monsters were subject to the agendas of the humans. Let's drop King Kong on Mount Fuji and make him fight Godzilla. Let's go get Mothra to get rid of Godzilla and kick him out of the country. Let's talk to Mothra and get her to get Rodan and Godzilla to stop bickering and swearing at each other and go fight King Ghidorah. Let's wake Godzilla up so he can kick the crud out of this big old lobster. Let's do this. Let's do that. So, like, by this point, Godzilla is not being controlled. He's a free agent. And so when Anguirus leaves Monster Island, it's not at the behest of reporters or military people or scientists pleading with him for help. He's operating on his own agenda. That's Godzilla's agenda. Yep. And the humans are just like, why is he here? We should probably shoot him.
Well, and they hear the tape. That's the thing. We get Chekhov's tape. They play the tape, and we found out that they use the tape. The tape makes this weird noise. I'd love to know what sound engineers they had at Toho who came up with that noise, because it's an interesting noise. I've not that and the lady guard, I have not heard those sounds replicated anywhere else. So I'd love to know if that's hidden someplace in some sound library someplace. I would love to have it. Anyway, and so they start playing it and they're like, what is that? Strange things are happening. You, Anguirus, you go figure it out. And then he comes back. He's like, yeah, the human shot at me, and I don't think I there's shady stuff going on. And this is where we keep our stuff. We might want to do something,
Yeah, basically.
It's not weird to me.
No. And you have to also take into account that it is stated up front at the beginning of the introduction of the Nebulans that their goal, just before we even know they're we kind of know they're aliens, but it's before the humans know that they're aliens, that one of their goals, and we'll get into this when we talk about Children's Land, is they want to wipe Monster Island out. They want to kill all the monsters off and replace them with models. So it doesn't strike me as weird that maybe that was kind of on that. That might've been part of the tape. Like maybe they heard that and they were like,
they put their evil plans on there
on the tape,
on the tape. Yeah. That would be a funny thing for you to put into the novelization. You can actually hear, like, catch the subliminal messages in there, yeah, where it's like,
maybe
it's
something
like,
baked in.
Gigan, destroy everything. Kill Monster Island.
And then he's like, Godzilla, yeah. Who's Gigan? And
that seems wrong. Because like, those tapes are, like, clearly those tapes aren't, like, just a record of bad guy plots. They're designed to summon Ghidorah and Gigan from space. So they're a summoning tape, basically, and those tapes are. And so, mm-hmm, you know, maybe there was something in there that tipped them off. Who knows?
Weirdly enough, now that I think about it, I'm about to draw an interesting parallel here. And it would be actually pretty relevant to you as a novelizer, but it's not unlike in King of the Monsters 2019, where Ghidorah starts summoning the rest of the Titans, and according to the novelization, the one who said "screw you, no" was Kong.
Yeah, Kong was just kind of like, "Nah, I'm good. I'm gonna."
Yeah. Except in this case, they hear the tape and they're like, "Uh oh." We need to do something about this.
That was meant for monsters, but not for us.
Not for us. We need to do something about this.
That's wrong. Something's wrong here. Yeah. The monsters in this are so good. This is a movie where it's just a lot of fun to spend time with the monsters, which feels weird to say, but because that's really the appeal of these movies in a lot of ways. But this is a movie where I always think about the human characters first.
Yeah.
You know, I love them so much.
So anybody out there who still has this crazy idea that humans don't matter in kaiju movies, watch this, and if you don't change your mind, we have to have a talk.
It's to each their own. However, we cannot move on from talking about the monsters because we do have two honorary monsters in this film that we need to talk about.
That's where I'm going to get into that with the thematic stuff. Part of that. I think they're part of the meta commentary.
Oh, I think so very much too. And I guess we should probably move on to that. But there's one technical aspect we haven't mentioned yet that absolutely needs to be talked about, and that is the music.
Yes, we do need to talk about the music. Because here's the fascinating thing. Other than, I think, two songs in this, everything's recycled. And then the two songs that are new are actually pop songs. And as I said in Hetera, it's interesting to look at the 70s movies, 70s Godzilla movies, and see how there's more pop culture influence in this. Because other than really Terror of Mechagodzilla, all the 70s Godzilla movies have a pop song in it. Save the Earth and Hetera. This has the Godzilla March. And who's the guy who recorded it? I had it in my notes, but if you know offhand, that would be great.
Yeah, so are we talking specifically about
Ishikawa?
Okay. I gotcha. I wasn't, because there are actually two pop songs written for this.
Yes. Go Go Godzilla, which is kind of funny, and Defeat Gigan, which were those were released on the album, and then there's the Godzilla March at the actual end of this.
Yeah, Susumu Ishikawa is the one who sang the Godzilla March. Mm-hmm. The one that is heard during the credits. I love that.
And then
that
Megalon has the Jet Jaguar fight song, as MST3K put it. And then we have the King Caesar song in Mechagodzilla. And then Terror of Mechagodzilla was like, screw that. We're going all the way back to the 50s. So, yeah. You know, so it's really interesting. But everything else is all, it's a Fukube music, but it's all recycled. And you might think that might be a bad thing, but every time I watch this movie, I am astonished how well they utilize all this recycled music. They do it so well, you wouldn't, if you were like me and you hadn't seen most of those other Toho movies, you would have assumed that these tracks were composed for this film.
They match beautifully. I honestly, here's what I'm going to say. I think that of all the elements that were poured into this film to try to make that make it feel like a 60s film, the one element that 100% succeeds at that is the music.
Yeah.
Because this is music from the 50s and 60s.
It's mostly the 60s. As I'm looking, I've got the list here, which I'll rattle off in a moment.
The one 50s dip is Battle in Outer Space.
There's two.
Oh, that's right. Never mind. You're right. There is another one, isn't there? Yeah.
Called The Big Boss from 1959, is not the Bruce Lee movie. And if I remember correctly, that was written by Sekizawa.
Yes, it was. It was written by Sekizawa. So two 50s pulls, a majority 60s. And a lot of them weren't even Godzilla films. They pulled from other movies.
Three of them are Godzilla films.
And then you've got pulls from other kaiju films. And then one from the Mitsubishi Pavilion at the 1970
from
Expo
70. If you want to learn more about Expo 70, go listen to my episode on Jiger. Is that right? Go listen to my Gaimura versus Jiger episode.
Go ahead and list those off.
Well, we already mentioned The Big Boss, and then there was Battle in Outer Space, obviously, which I think
it's
the opening theme. Yeah.
Yeah, they use the opening titles, and then they also use the opening. They were going to use that to open the movie in general, but it was ultimately decided to move that to a different position.
Yeah, because Jun Fukuda thought that it would be too recognizable as like a 15-year-old movie.
They were like, that's a little too, because Battle in Outer Space is one of Ifukube's best soundtracks.
It's not quite 15 years old, but... Yeah, close. Yeah, but then it's, according to Toho Kingdom, you also have music from Atragon.
Mm-hmm.
Then one of the actual Godzilla pulls, Mothra versus Godzilla, another Godzilla pull, Ghidorah the Three-Headed Monster, Frankenstein Conquers the World, or Frankenstein versus Baragon. King Kong Escapes, the third Godzilla pull, which is Destroy All Monsters, and then interestingly, Latitude Zero.
Yeah.
And then something from 1970 called Will to Conquer.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what that is.
So it was one of the three weird pulls. So you've got that, you've got Big Boss, and then you have the Mitsubishi Pavilion. Yeah. The Mitsubishi Pavilion
was the last one on the list.
Yeah, and that's you hear that in the movie during that Anguirus Decides moment where the tower blows up.
Oh, the down, 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 down,
down, down, down, down, bum, 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 bum. That's the Mitsubishi music. So, yeah.
Which, and then wasn't that the one that was actually directed? There was something, is it a music poll? There was something that was from Expo, I think it might be this, from Expo 70 that was directed by Bono.
I don't remember if that's the same thing.
I know. I just remember that came up. It was like, that was a bit of irony. Like they pulled something from one of Bono's Expo 70 projects for this.
Yeah. And also contrary to popular opinion on this, Ifukube was involved in the soundtrack for this film. They didn't just send him a letter that says, oh, by the way, we're using your stuff.
Wait, it says which of my sources brought this up? I don't see who brought this up. Might have been Callet. Looking at the rest of this, might have been Callet. It says some of the scores from Birth of the Japanese Isles.
I believe. Ooh, I'm trying to think of which piece was from. Maybe the opening, which was later evoked as part of Ifukube's Requiem and Destroya. That might be it.
Mm. Anyway, oh gosh, you were saying.
I was saying that Ifukube was actually brought in to help select music and do some of the mixing, the remixing of his music for this film. So it was not a case of him not being involved at all. They didn't just send him a letter and say, hey, we're doing this without you. He was involved. He did have a role behind the scenes in some of the selection. So he was, like, when you see him credited as the composer, it's not like an honorary thing, stock music, but like he was there, but he didn't have anything to do with the original pieces that were commissioned for the film, specifically the two pop pieces and Gogo Gojira, the second pop piece, which is included on the album that was released for the film, is not in the film anywhere. Mm-mm. And it is a banger of a fun jazzy piece too. I love that song. Mm-hmm. And you got to dig for it. It's out there. It's on YouTube, but it is, it's not in the movie, but I think that they picked the right one. They were only going to pick one to include the Godzilla March. is so. It's just a lovely, fun song.
Yeah, as our friend Elijah would say, it's a bopper.
It's a bopper. Okay, it's a bopper.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, it's a fun little thing, and I do appreciate that the Criterion Blu-ray is actually subtitled it.
Yeah,
which is actually I know people lob legitimate criticism at those Blu-rays, but something almost nobody talks about is the subtitle work that Criterion did on those movies, because it's some of the best subtitle work that these movies have ever gotten, including, like I said, subtitling the songs, which were done very inconsistently with previous releases.
Yeah. Now the Criterion subtitles do take a couple shortcuts here and there, and some of it's not completely accurate, but it gets the point across in a respectful, concise way. They cut things down a lot, I've noticed. They'll take sentences and condense them, but what they produce is respectful enough. Sometimes you can hear the differences, but they did do a good job, and especially for some of those releases that only had dub titles before.
Yeah.
Or like King Kong versus Godzilla, which had no subs.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, none at all. Yeah. So
which
they did great.
Which actually, again, going back to some of the stuff we talked about with the dub, there's no unfortunate, introduction for Danny in this. When Gango's talking, he says, "Mama gun." Now, I do want to talk about the name at least, and that's how it's subtitled. It says "Mama gun." I used to think that was something that was just made up for this movie. It's not. I think it was an early 70s meme in Japan.
It literally was,
because
though.
There's a strikingly similar situation with it in Return of Godzilla, the 1971 Ultra series. And I was watching, it's like, "Mama gun is in this too? What?"
Well, the mama thing was a whole thing, and it actually is kind of the weird dark spinoff of the women's lib thing I was talking about before. So in the 1960s, as a result of more women entering the workforce and being more involved in the economy, there was a subset basically of parents, of mothers who kind of came out of this that became somewhat unsettlingly obsessed with their children's like school and their education. They were called Kyoiku Mama. And the Kyoiku Mama, that's the slang. And it can probably, like, they're also called education mothers or school mothers.
Yes, that's why it's the
Son
monster
of Godzilla mentions it.
Yeah, that's why, yes. And that's why that's the monster of strict mothers.
Yes, so it's a stereotype and a slang in Japan, the Kyoiku mother. And it's kind of a hated, like, pop culture like trope. They were seen as like very, very like not good figures. Almost comparable to like the overbearing tiger mother in a way.
Yeah, the most direct correlation, but like the modern term Karen.
Almost, but in a much more like helicopter parenting kind of way, kind of like a stage mom, but for higher education. Basically, I want my children to be in business one day and this was an epidemic in Japan that gave like mothers a bad name. It was a thing. There was an instance, and I'm not going to remember the exact numbers here, but there was an instance where they found out that there was a mom who was secretly paying this institution to like mess up the grades of her child in order to get him into a prestigious school. Now, the twist is that the school was for like 3 to 5 year olds.
Oh, jeez.
This was not a college. And I don't remember exactly what the amount of money was that was basically like paid off to these people to try to get her child into this school. But it became something of an epidemic at the time. And so the idea of the kind of helicopter education parent, Kyoiku Mama, and it wasn't like mother in Japan. They used the word mama, M-A-M-A, when, you know, kind of put into English words. So it's Kyokui Mama. Mm-hmm. So mama gone.
Yeah, which it should be noted, if you ever hear a kaiju name, you know, Barugan, Baragon, and you know, or even the movie Atragon, it's not for a kaiju, but it's, you know, it's for a warship. When you hear gon, that suffix, that is supposed to be short for dragon. So this is mama dragon.
This is the dragon
lady.
It's Princess Dragon Mom.
Yeah, it's Princess. Oh,
no. There she is.
And there we come full circle. Are you saying that Princess, or is it Princess? I think it's Princess, right? She's a princess.
Princess Dragon Mom.
Yeah, yeah. Well, no, I'm trying to think in the actual subtitle version. Beelzebub, no, Elzebub. Are you saying Elzebub is a mama gun?
I'm not saying that. What's up? Also, I just confirmed those numbers while I was sitting here. It's called Aoyama Gakuen. That's the name of this essentially preschool, and it was $95,000.
Jeez.
A bribe of $95,000 on the part of this restaurant owner to essentially get this child into a 3 to 4 year old age range kindergarten. And it was because this was a prestigious kindergarten. It was associated with a big university. And they were like, well, this is going to seal my child's future right here. So the super strict do your homework mother was a trope and a like negative stereotype in Japan at the time. That's what mama gun is. There you go.
It's so wild.
Fascinating, you know, isn't
but
it?
Like, but like I said, like it wasn't just that. What was it again? The one you mentioned? The term.
For the helicopter parent, yes. You mean? Okay, sorry, my brain just completely turned off, and that is the Kyoiku Mama.
But so that trope is floating around, that stereotype's floating around, but the fact that the term Mama Gun was showing up in other pop culture things in the early 70s, it was in Return of Ultraman, and I feel like I saw it in one other thing that was from the early 70s as well.
I think it might, not Kamen Rider, is it?
It might have been Kamen Rider, either that or it might have been another Ultra series that would have been after Gaiden, I think.
Okay.
Maybe. I'm not entirely sure.
Taro, maybe?
It might have been Taro. I could be wrong. But I do remember watching Return of Ultraman and actually comparing release dates. Like, I looked up when this episode of Return of Ultraman aired versus when Gigan came out, because I was wondering if Gigan actually started the trend, and I think it might have, because the Return of Ultraman episode was toward the end of its run, which would have been in 1972.
Mm-hmm.
Not that it was after, it might have been around the same time.
Intriguing that a Return of Ultraman compilation film was paired with Gigan in theaters for the Champion Festival.
And there, that is, that makes you wonder if they threw the same episode in there. They probably didn't, but it would.
No, that one wasn't there, but yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, my mind was blown when I saw that.
It just goes to show you that even some of the silliest things in the franchise that people in America might think are quote unquote random might have a cultural backstory that you don't know about.
Yeah.
Always look into this stuff. It's fascinating to learn about. How many people out there knew what a Kyoiku Mama was before this? Yeah,
we are edumacating the peoples.
This is a good example of like how Godzilla and an interest in Godzilla opens up an interest into Japanese cinema, culture, history. It's so good.
Yeah.
It's fascinating stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. By the way, random fun fact, the Monster Island Control Center, that's now Monarch Outpost 83 on the island. Just thought Monarch took that thing over because they were like, you know, like those two foreign guys who were running things at the Antarctic base. Like, it's kind of the same thing. That's why they're like, oh, they got away. And that's all they do.
Monarch is like the Prometica of.
Well, no, Monarch took it over, they did more than just call in and say like, hey, the monsters got away. But yeah,
that's fair.
Anyway, but you know, we've been talking about this movie for twice its runtime. Jimmy's kind of looking at me. It's like, yeah, you might want to wrap this up. So I, as much as I would love to go into all of my notes as usual, I take way too many notes, do way too much research. If you want to see all of my notes, join MIFV Max on Patreon and you can read all the things or check the list of sources on the MIFE website when you go and you look at the full show notes there and you can get all the sources. But I do want to make sure, because we've been hyping it, we have to talk about the meta commentary, because this for me is the most fascinating aspect of this movie. So this meta commentary of Godzilla as a pop culture icon. So I'll try to get through this relatively quickly. Feel free to jump in and contribute, Danny, because I'm sure you've got plenty of knowledge about this too. So
I might.
It goes without saying, at this point, Godzilla is having a meteoric rise as a pop culture icon, especially in Japan. You know, you saw throughout the 60s that we had the kaiju boom. This is in the middle of a second kaiju boom, mostly on television with henshin heroes. You know, this is a big deal. You know, we've got Ultra Q and Ultraman and Kamen Rider and every major studio making kaiju movies and some of the foreign studios making kaiju movies at this point. I've done a couple of those Korean things. You were on for one of them. So
sure was.
Yeah. So, you know, it's a huge deal. Like this one movie from 1954, once you trace its history, blew things up and completely redefined Japanese pop culture. Okay, goes without saying, even though we just said it. All right.
True.
So, Godzilla Kaiju are everywhere. In fact, in 1969, a Canadian animator named Marv Newland made a simple, darkly humorous 2-minute short called Bambi Beats Godzilla.
Oh, boy.
And it's 2 minutes is too long for it, to be honest, because all that nothing really happens is Godzilla steps on Bambi. The most obvious thing happened. And funny enough, that was named. It'd be hilarious to do an entire episode talking about this 2-minute short. We should try that sometime. It was like a prank episode or something.
But April it was, Fools, anyone?
Yeah. I should. You know what? I should have done that. I should have did that on the Cellcast when I was asked to come on to talk about a short. I should have said, let's do Bambi Bambi Meets Godzilla, because it's just... Anyway. it's the Monty Python foot thing. Anyway, but it was named number 38 in 1994 for the 50 Greatest Cartoons by the Academy Film Archive.
Dang.
Oh, no, excuse me. No, it's just number 38 in 1994 is the 50 Greatest Cartoons and was preserved by the Academy Film Archive in 2009.
Oh, okay. That's still pretty cool.
Yeah, I got that wrong. I'm sorry.
Wah-wah.
And then obviously we've seen how versatile Godzilla is. You go back and listen to all the episodes where we track that history, how he's gone from an atomic allegory to a force of nature to a B-movie monster, a superhero, the embodiment of the World War II dead, victim of the nuclear bomb. Like, it's like he's such a versatile character, which is a big part of what kept him going. When all of Toho's other franchises died in 1970, Godzilla kept going. It's crazy.
It is.
Yeah.
So the longevity is insane.
Yeah. So
thank goodness he did.
Yes, for sure. And there was a guy by the name of Tadao Sato on the Godzilla Criterion Blu-ray special featurette. He argued that Godzilla is sympathetic for Japanese audiences because he has a vaguely humanoid design and he has lumbering movements and that endears him to the audiences despite his wrathful nature. Again, because he's a victim of the bomb. Then that brings us to what we're seeing here. So here's a quotation from Mr. Khaled related to that. This was what really triggered this idea in my head. Quote, visitors to the Monster Museum will learn what World Children's Land wants them to learn. When the cockroaches announced that Shukra and Mamagon, Shukra is the homework monster, are excellent ideas and plan to include them among the Monster Island detainees in the museum, they reveal their preference for monsters with easy-to-package, superficial relevance. Lacking ambiguity, Shukra and Mamagon are less politically threatening than something like Godzilla. Toho makes money by selling the likeness of a character whose popularity was established in movies that often criticize the profit motive. Godzilla's expressive power as a symbolic figure is at odds with his value as a commercial icon. Reduced to a mere commodity, Godzilla no longer raises uncomfortable questions. End quote.
Mic drop.
Yeah, mic drop right there. We could almost stop there, but we can't. So, no. As this illustrates, this newfound fame comes with the danger of losing relevance. Sekizawa may have been commenting on the state of Godzilla at the time, or at least the studio's attitude, Toho's attitude toward Godzilla. Godzilla began in a deathly serious film that was an expression of the Japanese people. Now he was being marketed to kids as a commodity to make profit. He was being simplified, perhaps even defanged. At least, I'm reading this off of my notes, by the way. Like, this was a whole thing I put together. At least that's what they did when they were selling Godzilla as a product. He was safer, friendlier. In some ways, it wasn't unlike his competitor, Gamera, who was less ambiguous and threatening, because he's the friend to all children, you know?
Oh, yes.
That isn't to say that he was like that in the films, but it certainly reflects the attitudes of many. And here's where I get crazy. This is where I go a little bit. It's inspired by Callot, but I go a little bit farther than Callot, I would think, from what I can remember of that essay. We see this symbolism go further in the film. When Godzilla sees the tower made in his image, going back to how everyone's confused in this, this commercialized version of himself, he slaps himself in the head to clear his vision, as if shocked by what he sees. Perhaps he looked at it like someone looking in a mirror and saying, "What have I become?" What happens next? The Nebulans attack Godzilla with a laser beam that emits from the tower's mouth like a deadly toy imitating the King of the Monsters. The aliens themselves, disguised as human businessmen who use technology to command monsters for their own nefarious purposes. That is a theme in the movie, over-reliance on technology.
Yes.
Kind of fascinating. That's why I was making the jokes at the beginning here. So anyway, they do this, and they nearly kill Godzilla using their facsimile. This was not unlike studio executives finding ways to market Godzilla as a product devoid of his deeper meanings. It's interesting, then, that it takes several ordinary people, including a misunderstood artist, to save Godzilla from certain death. Then, half-dazed, Godzilla destroys what's left of the tower after being thrown at it by Gigan, after which he gets his second wind, or as they say in the pro wrestling world, some babyface fire, and proceeds to trounce the space monster. It's one of my favorite moments in the entire movie, by the way.
Oh, it's great.
When Godzilla gets his second wind, he's like, "Come on!"
Yeah.
And then the music kicks in when Gigan's like, "Fine. You want me to bring it, brah? I'll bring it, brah." And then he...
Oh, yeah.
And then Godzilla's like, "Oh, you want this? Tail whip." I love that moment. It's a fist-pumping moment right there. Anyway, my last line related to this. The true Godzilla, not the commercial facade, could fight unencumbered.
That's good. That's good. This is one of the most fascinating elements of the movie to me, is the fact that it very well might be a movie that talks about itself, the state of the franchise that it's a part of. 12 movies in, 18 years on, Godzilla was very different. You know, the nuclear metaphor, the depth, the fear associated with the character had long since dissipated. Any kind of discussion of nuclear devastation is now separate from Godzilla. Like, there's still talk of it in this film because it's implied that horrible things happened to the original inhabitants of Nebula Space Hunter M, but Godzilla didn't do that. So he's a straight up superhero in this. And I think that there's another layer there. And this is actually kind of fascinating. This is something that Hiroshi Ishikawa himself, Gengo, the actor, brought up in an interview where he said something to the effect of the Japanese public image of nuclear power and nuclear energy 18 years later was comparatively more positive. And this is actually something I don't see talked about a lot. Like, within a few months of Godzilla releasing in theaters in 1954, the paperwork was signed by the Japanese government to start building power plants. That was almost right on the heels of Godzilla. And the first nuclear power plant in Japan was fully established and built in 1966. Big year for Kaiju. And Tokai, it's the same power plant that Godzilla tries to destroy in Godzilla 2000. The Tokai power plant. And then in the 1970s, the early 1970s, they started building more using heavy water. And so by this point,
that sounds familiar.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So by this point, nuclear power was starting to be folded into the Japanese public consciousness a lot differently than it was. Now, they still didn't have nuclear weapons because the three principles were still kicking, still are. So there was a shift, like, okay, well, here are nuclear weapons, here's nuclear power, here's how we can, to borrow a phrase from a Godzilla film, make peace with the demons who created our wounds, mm-hmm. right? So the idea of, like, the nuclear anything, atomic anything, was seen very differently in the early 1970s in Japan than it had been a couple of decades earlier. The wounds from the bomb had not healed. The wounds from the Lucky Dragon incident were not quite gone, but nuclear stuff, the nuclear world, the atomic world looked a lot different at that point, and it looked different in Japan. Now there were nuclear power plants in Japan, and so nuclear energy was seen as not just not a bad thing necessarily, but a positive. So how does that feed into Godzilla in the 1970s? And Gengo himself argued in this interview that the construction of those power plants and the kind of softening of the image of nuclear energy was a kind of an, maybe not an influencer, but it definitely played a part in Godzilla being a little softer than perhaps he was before and seen in a slightly different, more positive light. Now, is that why he became a hero? No.
I think it definitely parallels.
But there's a parallel. Like, yeah. Like, did they make him a hero because suddenly nuclear power plants are being built? No, that is the no. There are so many reasons why Godzilla transitioned from villain to hero in the 1960s and into the 70s. And I don't think that's one of them. But there is a parallel there. And it very well might have been, it's nothing else. It's an interesting parallel. And I thought it was a quote and an interview worth bringing up, because mm-hmm. there is an element of that plays into that commercialization of Godzilla and the metatextual potential metatextual nature of the film, where this is a Godzilla movie that in some ways turns the mirror back on itself, looks at itself and analyzes itself, not just as a film, but as a franchise, and not just as a franchise, but as a character that leads mm-hmm. that franchise. Yeah. So
and
there's a lot going on.
And in a way that it's not obvious.
Yeah, it's
that's
not.
That's what I love about it. It's not like, I don't know if this is a fair comparison, but, you know, even because it works for what it is, because it's funny, you know, but only a character like this could get away with it. It's like the new Deadpool and Wolverine movie, where Deadpool flat out makes comments about the dumb decisions that Marvel has been making. And it's done in a bit of a humorous fashion, because, like, the audience is like, yeah, I know that. But Deadpool is the kind of character who can get away with that.
He can do it.
Yeah, yeah, he can do it. It's much subtler than that. It's woven into the story itself, and it's under the surface. You have to look for mm-hmm. it. You have to know context to really catch it.
And it is one of the more interesting interpretations I've ever heard for a Godzilla film. There are a lot of different ways you can look at some of these movies, but, you know, calling Godzilla versus Gigan a metatextual analysis, and in some ways maybe even like a postmortem for, like, that version of Godzilla, is one of the most fascinating interpretations out there.
Yeah, I mean,
it's amazing.
Khaled even went further in his essay and was bringing up how it's like, hey, let's bring back other monsters. They're popular, right? We can put them in this movie and make toys. And then they're like, hey, let's make a new monster who will look great as a toy. Oh, the cyborg penguin, he would look great as a Bandai. Spoiler warning, he does.
He really does. It's very true.
So, I mean, like, even the thought process, like, I can imagine Sekizawa just kind of sitting there and Tanaka is saying all these things, like, bring back the monsters people we know people like, and then we can merchandise.
Where the real money from the picture is made. Yeah, there it is.
Yeah, exactly. And, like, I can potentially see Sekizawa just being like, you know, I'm not as cynical as that guy over there, Mr., you know, Takeshi, but even I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, man.
it's interesting. And the other aspect of this is that Sekizawa at this point was already several movies into feeling he'd run out of ideas after having written for not just Godzilla, but, like, for the genre since 1958. It's now 1972. The guy's tapped out, man. Like, the fact that they got a few more movies out of him at this point is a testament to his genius as a screenwriter and a story person. But at this point, I would I would not be surprised at all if this was something that was very much present in his mind. Now, I've never seen an interview with Sekizawa where he flat out said, oh yeah, I made a Godzilla movie about Godzilla. I've never found that. But it is a fascinating interpretation, and it really does get you thinking.
I would like to think that it was done completely unintentionally.
It's
knowing
very possible.
What I know about Sekizawa, and when you look at the context in which the film was made, I would not put it past him to unknowingly throw all of those elements into this, which I think makes it even better.
Honestly, yeah. Foolish but cunning.
For sure. And I mean, we could probably sit here and we could point to a lot of the other things in here, you know, along those lines, you know, and it's really interesting. And I think if this is a reasonable interpretation, which I do think it is, it might make this movie just as, if not even more relevant now than it was in 1972.
This is just as, if not more relevant. Yeah, I think that looking at how Godzilla has spread even further in the, holy crap, 52 years since this movie came out.
Just him, but a lot of other Japanese pop culture icons.
Things
Ultra,
in general.
Ultraman, various anime. And you see we joke about this all the time now in the, you know, in the kaiju and toku fandom, you know, the Bandai mandates, you know, it's a punchline. And now apparently a band, I think there's a band that has that name now. They've performed
That's
on the
funny.
Island at least once, but they have little toys of themselves. It's funny, but I don't think they're made by Bandai though. That's the ironic part. They're working on that. They're up and coming, but you know, we joke about that all the time, you know, or in the 80s when the big joke was that all of the kids' cartoons were just 30-minute commercials. That is very reductionist. I've been watching some old 80s cartoons that I grew up with, and they're not. If you just think that they're just 30-minute toy commercials, you don't really know what you're talking about. And I think that's an insult to most of the people who were working on those shows. Like, yeah, they're like, we're basing this on a toy line, but we're going to do some cool stuff with these toys, with these so-called toy characters. We're going to make them interesting. And by making them interesting, the kids will buy the toys.
Yes.
And which is why I think, and this is, I mean, it's mildly tangential, I admit, but, you know, I want to take this opportunity to talk about this. It's like Ultraman Blazar. Mm-hmm. My understanding was that Ultraman Blazar's production got fast-tracked quick enough that Bandai couldn't come in with as many notes because Supero's like, sorry, we already started.
Yeah, we got all our pre-production locked
well,
in.
We
Too
already
bad.
Got it done, but check out these things. And then, you know, we can make toys of these, right? And Bandai's like, yeah, we can. Yeah, here's a couple of notes, you know? And,
yeah,
you know, and I think that's how it should be done. It should be the creators make stuff. They go to the toy company, product makers, or whatever, and they're like, hey, use these. And they're like, okay, we can use those. And then you do cool things with those characters or whatnot in the show, and guess what? The viewers are going to be like, I need to have that figure. Because Earth Garon is amazing. I need an Earth Garon figure. That would be me. I need an Earth Garon in my life.
And the toys of Earth Garon are pretty flipping rad. And that does filter into Godzilla relatively recently as well. You have Bandai to thank for the fact that Shin Godzilla evolves.
Yeah.
The fact that the two smaller forms are extant on this planet, it's something that the Anno and Higuchi weren't initially very crazy about, but Bandai was like, oh, actually, they did want to do it. Let me rephrase that. They were into it. And Toho wasn't sure about it. But then Bandai was like, well, Toho, let's put it this way. Do you like money? And Toho said, how many forms can we possibly have him evolve through?
Yeah, basically. You know, yeah. And some people have cynically said that I think at least when you get to the 90s Heisei movies, and they would even say the Millennium films were like this too, like they existed to make toys. I think that's a very cynical way of looking at it, like I said.
It's because it is.
Yeah. It's hard to deny that because Toho commodified everything at that
point. The good news is whether they exist, it's kind of like Ultraman, whether they existed, even if they did exist to make toys or sell toys, they put people in charge of those toy making money machine movies that actually cared. Mm-hmm. And we got some fun art out of it as a result. If it was a pure commercial exercise made by people who didn't give a crap, then Godzilla wouldn't still be going. The Heisei movies would have petered out. The Millennium movies never would have been made. It's unlikely that anything that's come out since would have been anything like that, but they got people.
Yeah.
And I know that there are still rumors that float around out there that the people who made the Heisei and Millennium movies didn't care. And that's such nonsense.
Yeah. I mean,
it's blatantly untrue.
There is a counter argument within the franchise you can make to that. Look at what happened with Godzilla 98, like the massive advertising blitzkrieg that went into that. Like, it is notorious for that. Trendmasters made a massive toy line because they're like, look at all the other Godzilla toy lines we made, and they sold like crazy. We're going to do it with this new movie. We're going to buy into the hype, and the movie's going to be a huge hit, and the toys are going to fly off the shelves. And then the movie came out, and it was not well received, shall we say, underperformed at the box office, and those toys sat on the shelves for months, and then that killed Trendmasters because they couldn't sell them.
Well, that's not completely what killed Trendmasters. What killed Trendmasters was Walmart. Look it up. It's a fascinating story.
Yeah.
But
Godzilla 98 did not help.
Godzilla 98 didn't help. But all that to say that literally all of these things, all of these crazy things, the mandates, the commercialization, the successes, the failures, the continuations, the you have to do this being whispered in your ear, the no, we totally need to keep making these movies for various reasons. All of that stuff on a metatextual level is represented in Gigan in some way. You know, 52 years ago, 12 movies into a 38 film franchise, 18 years into a franchise that's now 70 coming up here soon. That is kind of crazy. And it does lend a lot of interesting credence to this interpretation of the film. Now, was it the intention when Sekizawa sat down to write like the third or fourth draft of the thing? I don't think so. I don't know. But
Well, and actually, wasn't the first, I think you would know this. This sounds like something you would know. Wasn't the first Godzilla toy actually made in the mid 60s, kind of at that peak moment?
Yes. The first quote unquote toy, it's not really a toy, but it was like a good representation of Godzilla, was the Aurora kit.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Aurora kit was essentially shipped over to Japan, and Maru-san pretty much duplicated it in doll form with their soft vinyls. And that's where the name Sofubi comes from. Mm-hmm. Sofu for soft, and B standing in for V as in VI vinyl. So Sofu vinyl, Sofu B. And those toys became instantly iconic. And then once Godzilla started selling like hotcakes, now we've got Destroy All Monsters is coming out. Oh, we've got, you know, All Monsters Attack. We should probably do these toys for all three of the Yogg monsters, right? Like, oh, Ultraman, so much Ultraman. So that level of commercialization for Godzilla really kicked into gear in the mid 60s as well.
Yeah. And then it culminated a bit with Hedorah, where there's actual figures in the movie, which is really interesting because even though, and then you have this one that's potentially a satire, a, you know, satirical meta commentary, and the other thing, there's none of that. The products are not actually there. You have these potential satirical takes on it. The Godzilla Tower, like you know, what's a, you know, a more obvious commercialization of it? Oh, we'll make a giant action figure. Because that's what it boils down to. It's a giant action figure.
And it's also worth noting that the plans of the aliens, like I said before, is to kill the real monsters and replace them with models.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's really interesting to look at that, about the, you know, the dilution of what this what these characters mean when you start to commodify them, when it just becomes, how can we sell this? I'll just grab another, you know, example. It's like, oh, Superman means such and such and such and such. Yeah, that's cool, but can we make a really cool action figure of him and sell him?
Mm-hmm. And then how can we like repaint it 1,000 times and then write a plot into the story about him changing costumes so that people will buy 40 different Superman toys for one movie?
Yeah. It's just it starts turning into this whole thing. And I do think that that can eventually become a detriment to creativity, which is why we joke about the Bandai mandates, you know, like we do. And I think that Sekizawa was aware of that in some form or another and was commenting on it. And, you know, and in a very artful way, I don't think the movie necessarily gives a definitive answer other than to say the real Godzilla is the one that you should choose and not the commercialized version. It's not necessarily saying that the commercial aspects of the character are bad. It's not, I mean, this would be excruciating for you if the movie came out and said, like, you should not own 500 Bandais.
Oops.
You know, you are diluting Godzilla by doing so. You know, people who collect do it because they love the character and I think the best ones are the ones who do it because they understand what the character truly means and they can infuse that into the product. So maybe the product was made for very surface level reasons to make a profit, but the people who buy it can infuse the greater meaning into it and say, like, that's why I have this.
And that's one of the reasons that Sofubi in particular are such a beloved staple is because they are artisanal pieces. They are made pretty much by hand and in the same way they've been made since the 60s. They're all hand painted by craftsmen. There are people who will seek out Sofubi artists specifically because they like their work and because they'll sculpt them and or paint them. People will say, well, this Sofubi is from, and then list the name of the artist. It's like buying a painting. It's like buying something. It is a handmade craft, just like Tokusatsu is. So there is a level of that that feeds back into collecting. But in addition to that, if you're buying a mass market Bandai, it's much the same thing. I have 4 billion of these dang things because for me, it's part of my love of the characters, being able to pick up a monster. Let's just pick Godzilla as an example and turn the character around in my hand and see the shapes and the silhouette and feel the texture. It's like a way of getting closer to the character and honoring him in some way. I've immortalized it. I've given some space in my home over to this representation of this thing, right? It's not because I'm like a crazy hoarder or anything like that. It's because these things are significant to me. They're an extension of something that I love. So there is a positive angle that you can put on that whole commercialization thing. Because you can look at the toys and be like, oh, this is just putting money in Bandai's pocket. This is like all that stuff. But when I look at my toys in my collection back in Ohio, I never look at my toys and say, ha, this is a cynical cash grab that sucked money out of my pocket. No, I look at it and I go, man, I love that monster. Mm-hmm. You know, it brings me joy, and that's why I collect. That's why I do Godzilla stuff in general. It's just a joyful experience for me. And the Godzilla Tower does not impart any kind of connection like that. It does not have Godzilla's soul. It does not inspire the same kind of joy that Godzilla inspires. And so when it crumbles at the end, we feel no pity for it. We don't feel like, oh no, you ruined a beautiful sculpture. Oh no, this architecture is gone. It's like, screw you, Godzilla Tower. The real Godzilla is here now. Mm-hmm. And when he marches off into the sunset, it's like, there he goes.
Yeah.
That's the real deal. And may it always be so.
Yeah,
you know,
for sure. And like I said, I think this might be a good place to end. The ending is really bittersweet. It was several years ago after Nakajima passed. And in a strange way, even though the character he played is not in this scene, knowing that Satsuma is in that Gigan suit.
Mm-hmm. It gets to you.
It does get to you a little bit. And, you know, we're sitting here and we're talking about, you know, the hyper-commercialization and how it can dilute or lose the soul of the character. And interestingly, in this movie, in the final moments, in that very traditional, very American Western sort of riding off into the sunset scene here, we're saying goodbye to Nakajima.
Yeah. We're saying goodbye.
Yeah.
This is a bookend for him.
This was the bookend. He was the soul of Godzilla. and I don't want to diminish the work of the suit actors that came after him, particularly in the next three movies where they had a different guy in every movie. I don't want to diminish what they did, but it wasn't quite the same after that.
Godzilla felt a little different. I think it wouldn't be until Satsuma stepped into the role in 1984 that Godzilla's soul felt like it really was just being breathed back into that suit. Again, nothing against Toto Kawai and like all the folks who played the character in the subsequent three films. They were brilliant and energetic and fun, and they had their own personality that they added, but there's only one Haruo Nakajima, right? There will only ever always be that one. And in a world where it's possible we may never get Godzilla into a suit again in a motion picture.
Although there are rumors.
We have the shorts too, by the way. Like we have the short films, which are preserving Tokusatsu. But right now, those moments, especially as they get farther and farther away from us in time and space, but mostly time, they become far more precious. Because, I mean, obviously Nakajima is just like Satsuma, neither of them are with us anymore. And so Godzilla, like Nakajima will always be the soul of Godzilla, but it's far more precious now because his presence in this world and his soul is preserved in the moments that were captured on film with him in that costume. You know, that's what we have to remember him by. You know, we have our memories. If we ever got to meet any of these guys, I never met Nakajima. Yeah, I missed out a couple of times as well. And I'll always kick myself for that a little bit. Met Satsuma. We both did, but never met Nakajima. But this is one of those things. It happens every time something like this goes, like one of these people goes away, is they're not gone, right? Godzilla's soul and Nakajima's soul are still intertwined in celluloid, right? Those movies will forever stand as a testament to the work he did. And that ending to Godzilla versus Gigan will always be special, and it will get more special for different reasons as time goes on. It was special at the time because it was a great ending to a great movie. It was great. It was special in the interceding, or the following, I should say, decades, because it ended up being the end of the career of the guy who made Godzilla who he is. And then when Nakajima passed, it took on further significance as that's it. That really is like that. That's the last moment, and now he's gone. Mm-hmm. And the farther away we get from that, the more precious those moments become. And clearly that was not intentional on the part of the filmmakers. They didn't know he was never going to come back. It was just a heroic send off, but it's one of those beautiful kismet moments where you could almost believe it was planned, and it forever stands as an immortal bookend and a reminder of just how blessed this franchise was to have Nakajima-san as part of it.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
No, Jimmy, I'm not going to cry.
We're both teetering, I think, though. We're both teetering.
A little bit. I was just going to add that in a way, justifies the collecting, because if you're buying something that embodies a moment with one of these people,
mm-hmm.
you know, you're owning a piece of that. You know, it's almost like a little memorial. So,
I agree.
Yeah. Anyway, we need to start wrapping things up.
We do.
All right, as the host, I'm making an executive decision. I was going to go over some listener feedback, but we've gone on long enough.
I think we have. This was a heck of a discussion.
And I've had listeners tell me that from now on, when I have you on the show, I need to have you on by yourself because this will happen.
They might be on to something. Yeah.
I mean, it's nothing compared to the 7 hours you went with Elijah.
I still wake up sweating from the... No. That was fun. I don't have a lot of those in me, but that was a fun time.
Yeah, for sure.
7 hours.
So we will be saving the listener feedback for hopefully the next episode. Maybe even the episode after that, and you'll understand what I mean there in a moment. In the meantime, Daniel.
Yes.
We got a... do a very important segment of the show that technically involves you. And you know what that is?
I feel like I have a theory. Does it involve Patreons and shout outs? I shall ask me once again, will you shout my name? Manny Badana of the Godzilla Bookification Doohickey.
Damon Noyes, our executive producer at this point.
The one, the only, Cellcast.
Eric Anderson.
Winja, the ninja.
Ted Williams.
Christopher Reiner.
The indiscreet one, or is it indiscreet one? Please tell me. I've been waiting to find out. I need to know.
Eli Harris. Oh, yeah.
Jake Hambrick, one of my co-hosts on Henshin Power V3. Go listen now.
Matthew Walsh, but not that Matthew Walsh.
Jonathan Cartwright. He's a crazy, crazy wild man.
Leon Campbell.
Michael Watson.
Edwin Gonzalez.
And our newest patron, Eric Pearl! Tofu! I'm like turning into the ultimate warrior here for a second.
Headphone malfunction. Goodness, you tofu'd a little too furious.
Headphones fell off. Headphone malfunction. I know, it's better than the wardrobe. All right.
Wow. Ladies.
Don't lecture me about dated references, okay? That is funny coming from you. You are a dated reference.
Wow. So much anger. Are you invited? You're not invited to the wedding.
What
okay,
are you? What? Come on, dude! You can't do this to me. You can't do this to me.
Okay. You know what? It was a funny joke. Clearly, like Jimmy, he's still invited, right? Jimmy. Okay. Good. Okay. You had me worried there for a second, buddy. Like, I thought you were serious. Man, you really riled him. Wow.
I've been snubbed for a lot of things.
Oh.
I wouldn't have wanted to be snubbed for my best friend's wedding. I'm just saying.
Jimmy, you just hashtag triggered the Marchand. Come on. Like, I get that it was okay. Why are you apologizing to me?
Yeah.
I didn't do. Okay. Give Nate a little pat on the back. Throw him a bone.
Yeah. Yeah. Not literally, please. That would be weird.
Please don't throw a bone. I see you.
Yeah, I've seen Deadpool and Wolverine. I know what happens when you start throwing bones. I'm just saying.
This is true. Yeah. I mean, I'm going to assume I have not seen it, so I don't know what you're talking about. But not a clue.
Okay. Yeah. You should go see it.
Maybe.
Thank you, Jimmy. Okay. Yeah. We're not going to hash this out on the air. We told crisis averted.
Yeah, Jeepers,
we told ourselves that we weren't going to hash things out on the air anymore. It's not healthy.
That's fair.
It's not healthy.
That's fair. It makes some of the third wheels amongst us uncomfortable.
Yeah. That's like my whole life. Now, anyway, wow. let's talk about the upcoming episodes. Can we talk about upcoming episodes?
Yeah, let's do it.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's do that. Yeah, so let me bring it up because I'm a little flustered right now. Let's see. So speaking of Eric and Nerd Chapel, Eric Anderson of Nerd Chapel, he'll be joining me on the next episode. And guess what, Danny? We're leaving Thailand. It's been fun here. And, you know, it sounds like we're going to have to give a little bit of a ride to Jacob Lingle. You know, he came on for the lake and he's been working remotely a little bit while we're here. And we are finally taking this world tour into Europe.
There you go. It's happening.
Yes. And we are going to Norway. Yes. The land of Thor.
Ooh, Thorway.
Yes. Thorway. Uh-huh.
Thank you, Jimmy.
Yeah, Thorway. Take a wild guess what we're talking about.
Ooh, does it involve trolls or hunting them, perhaps?
Yes.
Or just trolls?
Yeah, no. Not to be confused with the Netflix movie that you and Michael came on to talk about.
Yeah, so it's troll. We're doing Troll Hunter. Okay.
We're doing Troll Hunter. Not troll,
great movie.
Troll Hunter.
A great freaking movie.
Yeah, it's an interesting example of the kaiju genre. You know, it's a little bit like Cloverfield because it's a found footage movie, but it's a very different tone and a different sort of story. And
it's good. It's one of the better found footage movies that I've seen. I'm not like a big banner waving fan of it, but I'm also not a hater of found footage. I think it can be an incredibly creative genre, and Troll Hunter is a good one. Like, that's a real good one. Like, if you want to watch a movie that actually, I think, benefits from the format of found footage, definitely watch Troll Hunter out there, folks. If you've not seen it, it's good. It's really good.
Yeah. Yeah. And now you'll have a podcast to listen to after you watch it.
Yes.
And
yes.
Then, we've got a little bit of a theme for the next couple of episodes, because for a fifth Wednesday bonus episode, I will be talking about another found footage kaiju movie that fits our theme. The Barbados Project.
A rare instance of a giant monster flick I've not seen.
It is back on Tubi, I am happy to report. It was on Tubi for a hot minute, then kind of disappeared. Now it's back. And for a while, it seemed like the only place you could watch it. I don't even remember the name of this website, but it was a website that specialized in found footage horror movies. Like, independent found footage horror movies. And it was...
So you could find it on Tubi, and then you could find it not Tubi. Thank
if
you.
If I was
easiest,
ever...
stupidest joke I'll make all night.
Yeah, I mean, if I was ever to... I have toyed with the idea of starting a podcast that's just about finding weird stuff on Tubi every week, and I would call it Tubi or not Tubi.
It didn't deserve the second. It didn't deserve the first from shit that I got.
Okay. Well, Jimmy's being nice because after what happened a minute ago, he's like, you know what? You can have the rim shot.
He's throwing bones.
Yeah, he's throwing bones. Those are the bones.
Apparently means something that I don't know because I've not seen a certain movie about pools that are dead.
I'm amazed that hasn't been spoiled for you. But anyway, then guess what? We talked a fair amount about it tonight. Well, let me back that up. We talked about it a fair amount today when we were with this film, but Godzilla Redux is continuing. And we're getting to one that's kind of significant.
Yeah, this one I have to imagine involves a lot of, let's see, car chases, more mustaches, interestingly.
Hairy chests.
A lot of fuzz. A lot of fuzz. A lot of body fuzz. A lot of peach fuzz. And maybe a little, underwater dancing. Like maybe some like underwater
with some unfortunate costuming.
No, it's only unfortunate if you actually look at it and pay attention. Wait, what?
Right. Wait, what? Yeah. No, we do that. We do that here. Yeah.
We do that, don't we? We pay attention to a lot of movies here, don't we?
Yeah, we do. But it's Godzilla vs. Megalon. Godzilla Redux is continuing, and yes, I have made arrangements. I know all you kaiju lovers are demanding it without actually telling me this. Jet will be on. Jet will be in studio for his movie. I promise.
That's fair. I don't recall demanding it, but that doesn't mean I didn't want it.
Oh, I'm anticipating. I know. Okay. I know that that's what the peoples want.
You've got your finger up on the pulse of your audience.
Yes, quite. Whoa, where'd that come from?
I don't know.
I slipped.
But no, Megalon's going to be, who's going to be on that episode?
Well, obviously our executive producer, Damon Noyes, who requested to be on it because he actually saw it during its original American theatrical run because he's old.
That is dang cool. I mean, not that he's old. That's not cool. But the fact that he saw it is...
No, it's cool that he's old. We like old people around
here.
He's
not that old. Dear God. Come on, poor Damon.
Him and Neil. Yeah. I mean,
no, Neil's old. No, I'm kidding. I'm joking. These are two spry gentlemen.
Yeah, but there was another guest that I for sure knew I had to have on the show. It teetered back and forth if she was going to be on... But I worked my magic a little bit, and I made one last little request to her. Yes. And she said yes. I'm happy to report that we will be joined by the Queen of the Fabulous Empire herself, Kaiju Kim.
Love to hear it.
Because she loves this movie, and I told her, it's just like, it's Godzilla versus Megalon. We're just going to goof around for like 2 hours, okay? There's like one really deep thing we can talk about. We'll get that done in 5 minutes, and then we're just going to goof around.
It'd just be silly.
It'd just be I'm silly. Because it's Godzilla versus Megalon.
I'm glad that she's up for participating in this one. I know this movie is really special to her, so that's going to be cool. That's going to be really, really cool. Been a hot minute since Kim was on the show too, so this is great.
Yeah, it has been a hot minute, and she's one of my favorite people.
She's one of the best people.
Yeah, in fact, actually, the last time she was on was with you.
Yes, that's right.
When we did our impromptu bonus early Biollante episode.
Yeah, that's right. So it'll be that. And then it's the magical combo of a Kim and a Damon.
A Kim and a Damon. Yes. And then, just throwing this out there, episode 100 is around the corner.
What shenanigans might ensue, I wonder.
I'd tell you, but then I'd have to have my producer kill you.
Oh, you don't want to get your hands dirty, Marchand. I see how it is. You always make your producer kill your guest, don't you? I see how it is.
He knows how to do it. He knows
this. I have no doubt that Jimmy has taken many lives in his time. Jimmy,
I mean,
you wouldn't.
The war in space, man.
War in space. It was brutal. Jimmy, you wouldn't kill me, would you? Oh. Oh. I'm sorry I asked. That's okay. I mean, we're going to move on. That's fine.
We're going to be. You're scaring me. You're scaring me. Kaguya, yeah. I hope Kaguya softens you a little bit. Oh, she already has. Oh.
Okay.
I guess he's just contemplating fewer ways to end you.
Jimmy would never. I can't say that anymore because I have reason to doubt now. You know what? Yeah, it's fine.
We're gonna move on. And I should have mentioned this before. If you want shout outs like what we just did a few minutes ago, join MIFV Max on Patreon for as little as $3 a month. There. Got that taken care of. All right. And now we come to one of the other most important segments of the show, and apparently, much like Momagon, one of the most highly memeable.
Do it. Do it, Marchand. Do it.
You're giving me permission?
Loath as I am to admit it, yes. I am giving you permission. Say the thing.
3, 2, 1. I'm counting wrong anyway. Shameless self-promotion!
Oh, shameless ear bleeding. No, it's fine. Oh. Hey, so I get to talk about myself. That's going to be fun. Hi.
I know it's one of your least favorite things, but.
Yeah, it's not one of my favorite subjects, but I do my best.
Yeah.
Okay.
Please be brief.
No. I've been on the show plenty. People know, probably know what's going on. But in case this is the first time you're hearing my rambly voice, when I'm not flying around the world on Pteranodon Robots co-hosting this podcast, I am back at home in America creating and authoring the Godzilla Novelization Project, which is an ongoing endeavor on my part to create full-length English language novelizations of the Godzilla films and share them 100% free with all the cool people out there. Yes, free is good. All the people who want to read them. These books are published serialized, one chapter at a time. I also publish, you know, either in parts or whole Godzilla adaptations that are short stories and novellas. The website also has timelines and, blog articles and all this crazy stuff. So if you're interested in reading the Godzilla films and seeing how my obsession with this stuff translates into prose retellings of the movies, head to GodzillaNovelizationProject.com. You can follow along with the project and see what kind of weird shenanigans I'm up to on Facebook. Just type in Godzilla Novelization Project. You'll find me. Same on the artist formerly known as Twitter. You can find
me
there.
Thanks, Danny.
Thanks, me. I finally get to use my own line. And about time. It's actually on the website now. I changed my Twitter link to the artist formerly known as Twitter on my Press and Appearances page. So it's canonized. It's in there now. So yeah, the GNP Twitter is getting dangerously close to 6,000 followers, which is crazy. You'll
I'm
find
only
updates
a little
on
jealous.
It's Twitter. It's not worth being jealous about. But yeah,
just retweet me a few more times and maybe I'll get to like 800 by there the end of the year.
We'll get you a little bit higher in the three digits.
Yeah.
No, it's I don't know how it happened, but it's fun. I share fun production stuff, film history stuff, updates, bad jokes, all that stuff. So check that out. I also have a Patreon, much as Mr. Marchand here does, for the GNP, which helps me get research material and, you know, maybe take a day off of work and not starve. And, you know, pay for translators and all that good stuff. It's really incredibly pivotal in helping make the project happen. So head over to the easiest way to do it is to go to the GNP website and go to the Patreon page and just click the link. That's the easiest way to do it. I'm also often on podcasts. You can find me on a lot of episodes of this show. You can find me on episodes of Kaiju Conversation. You can find me or live streams rather. You can find me on episodes that are of the streaming show that our dear friend Kim does. Mm-hmm. Donnie Winter has interviewed me. Like I'm all over the place. I've also write academically on kaiju movies. I wrote for the now defunct Kaiju Ramen magazine. You can find my stuff in G-Fan. Very soon you will find me on Kaiju United. I'm hoping to get some stuff up there. Yes. Heck yeah, Kaiju United. There's a lot. The only other thing that I absolutely have to drop here is that as of right now, I am the co-host of a audio commentary. I just did my debut audio commentary along with our good friend Elijah Thomas, mutual friend of Monster Island Film Vault, the host of Kaiju Conversation, and an all-around awesome dude. And he and I got to collaborate on a full-length audio commentary for the upcoming SRS Cinema Blu-ray release of Shinpei Hayashiya's War of the Ninja Monsters, Jaron versus Gora, which is a charming, funny, wonderful little independent kaiju film from one of the great indie kaiju filmmakers and somebody who's so passionate about this genre. And it was a true honor to get to yammer over that movie and drop some interesting history on Hayashiya-san's filmography and the history of Rakugo comedy in Japan. Interesting stuff. So if you want to support Hayashiya and SRS Cinema, I absolutely recommend going to their website and picking up the Blu-ray. And as a bonus, if you want to hear me yammer over it with Elijah and you want to hear what we have to say, turn on the commentary track. So that's fun. And gosh, I think that's pretty much the only other thing. I mean, there are a lot of things I could yammer about, but those are the big ones. Those are the big ones. I'll say one more thing. This year was a weird and wonderful, I got a weird and wonderful surprise. Every single one of my G-Fest panels was recorded in some way. Mm-hmm. I was on 7. The 7th one is not out yet. It's the Final Wars panel. But if you go to my social media and to the website, I now have links to 6 of the 7 panels I was on. So if you want to hear me wax philosophical with some super cool people like Mr. Marchand here, I got
to say a couple of those are on the MIFE YouTube channel.
Because your brother filmed them, which was so helpful. And so I have linked to his videos, and I did thank him in a post I made. That was incredibly wonderful that he filmed those. So if you want to hear a bunch of nerds and me talk about another nerd, talk about, you know, Mothra versus Godzilla anniversary, Mecha Godzilla, dinosaur comics, Final Wars, Nate, you and I, and some awesome people did the 54 panel to close out the show. Oh, it was wonderful.
That was a stacked panel. That was
that was a banger of a panel.
Jay, you, me, Jeffrey Engels, Kevin Horn, Elijah. That was
it was magical. It was magical. It was an honor to be on that thing. So if you want to hear a bunch of cool people talk about, and me, talk about that movie and a bunch of stuff, head to GodzillaNovelizationProject.com, and the links are there. And you know, they're preserved for posterity so people can hear what we all had to say. So that's about it. I'm done. Okay. That's it.
And
that's
the end of the list. I'll just mention here really quick, if you want to get more stuff related to the film vault, like the Patreon link and all that, check the show notes. As for what I do outside of the film vault, check out my author website, NathanJSMarchand.com. I'm also a contributing writer to Kaiju United.
Ooh.
Former contributor to Kaiju Ramen, you know, if we're going to bring that up.
Rest in peace.
Yeah, rest in peace. And also check out my other podcast, my new other podcast, Henshin Power V3, which picks up where both Henshin Men and the Power Trip left off, although there is going to be a little Power Trip reunion episode coming up soon as of this broadcast. We'll see how that goes.
I know what it is.
To be or not to be, that is the question. That's all I have to say on that.
It wasn't funny the first two times.
Yeah, good point. We've been at this for so long, we need to wrap things up. We are rivaling, what's the conspiracy theory radio show? Ground Zero. We're rivaling them. That guy rambles on for like 5 hours at a time, from what I understand.
Well, we're getting close to that now, so it's time for us cheeky pigs to take our leave.
We cheeky pigs.
Yeah. I gotta get on a boat and get out of Bangkok.
Yeah. But hey, I'll see you, because you know Jimmy's told me enough to know that the wedding's gonna be on Monster Island, so I'll see you on the island in a few short months.
I will be there. I would not miss Jimbo getting hitched for the world.
Mm-hmm.
He seems perfectly fine with wanting to kill me, but that's fine. Yeah. It's okay. That's okay.
What's a little casual murder between friends?
Let's not find out.
Good idea. Yay, yeah. Jimmy, Mr. I'm Getting Married Soon. Cue the credits. Thank you for listening to the Monster Island Film Vault, a podcast produced and hosted by Nate Marchand. Our executive producer is Damon Noyes. If you want to be heard on the show, we'd love to hear from you, so email us at monsterislandfilmvault@gmail.com. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and TikTok. You can also follow Jimmy from NASA on Twitter and our many colorful characters using the links in the show notes, which are on our website, MonsterIslandFilmVault.com. Don't forget to join our official Facebook group and Discord server, The Markalite Lounge. Our podcast logo was designed by Rebecca Hudgens. Follow her on Twitter and Instagram at super_r_illustrations. Sound effects sourced from freesound.org and created by JP Gant. Our theme song is Wanderer on the Offensive, live edit by B33J, Serax, Juan Madrono, and Nonsensical Lexus, which is a remix of Counterattack and The Opened Way by Koatani from Shadow of the Colossus. Additional music includes Every Country Has a Monster, performed by Jonah Ray, and Chant My Name, a cover by Second Archive of the Song by Masaki Endo. All film and audio clips belong to the respective copyright holders, and no infringement is intended or implied. Please rate and review us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and or Podchaser to spread the word about the show. You can even support us by joining MIFV Max on Patreon. MIFV is a Moonlighting Ninjas media production and a proud member of Pod Nation. Sayonara!